in Illinois. Are you doing hybrid or?
Hybrid, yeah.
Hybrid.
Yeah. Hybrid, and, yeah. So
yeah.
I will be teaching online, but there mm-hmm. are many lab classes are you know, face-to-face, one-to-one. We are starting the testing. So we are required to have testing twice a week. It's mandatory.
But how long do you have to wait to get the result?
Usually 5 hours.
5 hours?
Yeah.
Oh, that's that's great. Yeah.
Yeah. So no, you cannot access any university property without the testing being done. So everybody has the testing done, and we have an app that keeps track of who tested, who didn't.
Mm-hmm.
So we're testing 10,000 every day.
Yeah.
So in the 20 locations, and each test, you know, each saliva test.
Mm-hmm.
And then it takes about 2 minutes to collect the sample, and maybe another 90 minutes to 2 hours to get the results. And mm-hmm. then it goes directly saved in the app, and that goes to your smartphone. And then the tracking system that who is where.
Mm-hmm.
So all yeah. outside entries have been closed. So if someone is not tested, they cannot enter any building. All buildings are locked, will be locked for the entire semester.
Yeah.
And then if someone gets sick, then, or someone gets positively tested, then there'll be contact traced. And 5% of the dorm has been converted to sort of a semi-medical facility.
Oh.
About 2,500 beds.
Hey, Saif, mm. Can I ask you unshare your screen for the time being?
Unshare screen?
Okay. Yeah, quite a few people are.
Stop sharing. Okay. Okay,
right. Good. So Tan Li is here, famous Tan Li.
Hey.
Hey, Tan.
Good morning. How are you? Hey, Siddiq, good to have you here.
My God, your talk was so good last time.
Oh, thank you. Thank
I
you.
Was so impressed. Really, it was so, I was so good. It was so good.
Yeah, thank you for your question as well. That's part I enjoy actually the most. I left a comment somewhere. I don't quite remember. Said among the so many talks I gave, that's probably the one I learned the most as a speaker. You know, oftentimes as a speaker, you talk and people ask questions, and then I actually learn a lot. Thank you.
Hello,
your talk.
Hey, Celine.
Hi, Tara, Siddiq.
Hey.
Hi, Yuhang.
Hi,
how are you guys?
Good, good.
Good, how are you?
Siddiq, you don't come to EML webinar that often, right?
No, actually, everyone is there every time.
Really?
Yeah, he's there every time.
Yeah. I have to learn so much from you, Salim.
Oh, really? No, I haven't given a talk yet.
It's coming soon, right? Somewhere?
So, here is the thing. After lecture discussion is very long. Sometimes can be 2 hours. Nobody can sustain that. But the hope is, so it's a videotape. People can leave at any time.
Okay, yeah.
But it might be good for you to stay for 5 minutes, maybe ask one question or two, or so, because people want to see you. You're an important person, Siddiq.
Sure, that's what I was trying to avoid, but sure.
Tang
knows that.
A political question, a political question.
No, you can ask me whether whom should I vote in November.
Siddiq, you can regard this as a venue for outreach for you to the Chinese community.
You know, I do use LinkedIn sometimes. So Kiara's email, you know, after that webinar, I did put something on that, on the LinkedIn. Yeah. And then after yours, I did put a comment there. Under your post, so
thank you. Oh, Jimmy is here.
You know, today I told my wife that this is a talk for 1 hour, and then there is 2 hour questions, and she said, you know, how should you prepare yourself? You know, do you jog for like last 1 month, or do you have more protein for the whole month?
Okay.
And, then I told this is Harvard professors and, you know, the big people and knowledgeable people. And she said, okay, I take off for the day. You survive and then we'll see each other afternoon.
Hey, Jimmy.
Hey, morning, Jimmy.
Hey, how are you? Taher, how are
hey,
you?
Hey, Jimmy.
Good to see you.
To see you too. Singapore, still.
Yeah, it's tough,
night,
for,
right?
Tough for Jimmy, right?
Tough for Jimmy, oh. Yeah.
9:45, yeah.
I was telling Suleen that, you know, this time is perfect for the US audience and European audience, but very difficult for our Asian friends.
Yeah. It's a huge sacrifice to move to Asia.
Yeah,
it's a huge sacrifice to be for so long. And it goes until midnight or 1 o'clock, right, Jimmy?
Midnight, 1 o'clock sometimes, yeah. Right? Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Here, let me ask you this. I remember you got your degree from Cornell with Herbert Hui. Is that
Herbert
right?
Hui? Yeah.
So, but Herbert is a theoretician.
Yeah, yeah.
All what I kind did, of theoretician are you?
I do both. Depending on what I need to do, I don't do large scale computation. Some like MD simulations, but otherwise simple. You will see simple calculations, simple PDEs, ODEs that I can get by with. Because I think they give a lot more insight. Mm. I mean, Jigang, when I was a graduate student and junior faculty and onward, I learned so much from your papers.
Let me interview you.
No. You see, really, I tell my students that in your scientific paper, there are sometimes comments which are like novels, like little anecdotes here and there. And it was, I think yours and Jim Rice's, John Hutchinson's papers are, they always start from the base, always start from the scratch, and then soon go up to higher levels.
I remember meeting you when you were, I think, just graduated. And then suddenly you were working on MEMS.
Yeah, yeah.
A loading device.
That's right.
Well, we're testing many very small things. But how did you get that started? Yeah, where did
you
get
because I didn't. I didn't get any job after doing theory.
Well, seriously, let's go from basis, from basic steps. So
yeah, so people, I was I was interviewing many people. I mean, for postdoc, I interviewed for two faculty jobs, and in one of them, I was describing Duffing's equation, and I see my four committee members fell asleep. Mm-hmm. In about 15 minutes in the talk, I realized no hope. And then I started applying for postdoc, and at that time, Noel McDonald was the department head in electrical engineering. Uh-huh. And so I went to him, talked to him, and then he explained a lot of stuff. I had no clue. Uh-huh. And when I was leaving his office, he told me that, opportunity knocks only once. That was the only thing I understood. So I took his offer, which was very low in terms of money. Mm-hmm. But I talked to Herbert. He said, no, you go and work with Noel McDonald. So that's how I started the MEMS. I had no experimental evidence at all.
Yeah.
And as you know, Herbert doesn't like using computers.
Yeah.
He has to solve everything analytically, asymptotic methods, and, you know, very detailed. So it was a total flip to experimental systems. But it was good. I think at that time, MEMS probably was very beginning.
Right. And you immediately select a problem.
Mechanics oriented.
Yeah, testing small samples mechanically.
That's right.
Everybody was simply not around.
That's right, yeah.
And
it
was very much needed. So, but let me ask you, how long did you do your postdoc?
Oh, 4 years.
Oh, 4 years, okay.
4 years, yeah. Yeah. 2 years down the line, I got an offer from UIC, University of Illinois, Chicago. I signed the contract, but Noel was very unhappy with me. He said he would not write a letter for me unless it's in the top 10. But for many other reasons, you know, I had to resign from the job.
Uh-huh. From which job? From
the faculty position at the UIC.
Oh, okay.
Right, before even joining, yeah.
Wow.
So then worked 2 more years with Noel and then came to Illinois, UIC.
That's news to me even.
Yeah. It was a trauma, basically, at that time.
So that's the University of Illinois at Chicago, right?
Chicago, right. Yeah, there was something to do with visas and I got into troubles, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so then Noel said, resign immediately and come back to, and then he said, I told you so. Yeah. I would not write letters for you unless it's the top 10.
Yeah, and then back step. So with Herbert, you must did some theory.
A lot of theory, yeah.
So now, what did you do?
Interfacial crack, fracture mechanics, interfacial crack growth, Huey-Riddle theory, Huey-Riddle equation extension.
Okay, wow.
Elastic one side, creep on the other side, crack progressing between the interface, along the interface, asymptotic fields.
Wow. That's why you read the Zhigang's paper, John Hutchinson's.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Yeah, that's a famous paper. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, I was looking at Zhigang's, most recently, I was with Edward Arts. I was reading Zhigang's paper with, I think, with Rui Huang, on the instabilities of thin films on viscous material. The beginning of initiation of buckling due to the compressive stress, and because the buckling cannot happen freely because the viscous fluid has to creep through. So I and Edward, we had fun time discussing the paper, and I was developing some theory on suction cups, so it becomes very relevant. Yeah. Suction cups in liquids.
Yeah,
so Zhigang was at Santa Barbara at the time, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Yeah. Well, at Princeton now.
That time was Princeton?
Yeah, I was at Princeton. But back to you. So you, branched off to bio. How did that happen?
Sort of accident. One of my colleagues, after I joined, after about 2 years or 3 years, Jimmy was there at that time. So he was an embryologist and he came to me and said, can you test embryos for in vitro fertilization? So those who cannot become pregnant. So my sister was going through this process and I was very sympathetic to this one. So it's very, very costly and very emotionally charging for women who go through in vitro fertilization.
Oh.
So he said, can you test the embryos to see which is a good embryo, which is a bad embryo? Mm-hmm. So I started that work and then nothing happened. No result, zero. Spent 6 months. And then I wrote an email to Don Ingeber. Mm. I did not know him, but I saw his papers on mechanobiology.
Yeah.
And he sent me an email at midnight saying that you have to pluck the right string, full stop. And then PS, he said, I am sending my postdoc to your lab in 2 weeks.
Wow.
That was Phil LeDuc.
I see.
Yeah, so Phil comes to my lab and he explained to me what Don wanted to tell me by saying plucking the right string. And then Phil comes, explains to me, he leaves, and then Don sent me an email. He says, now it's your turn to come to my lab. So I go to his lab, I spend some time, and then he keeps sending me emails, you should buy now an incubator, you should buy a hood and so on. So it's kind of handheld process of getting into mechanobiology.
That's an amazing story. I never heard about this.
Yeah. I mean, we kept in touch for a long time until he became the VC director. Mm-hmm. Even after that, we had emails back and forth. Mm-hmm. Yeah, never collaborated. I spent a lot of time in his lab with my student.
Yeah. He was a person to talk about the tensegrity.
Tensegrity, that's right. integrity. Yeah. We used to stay in that, in the Hampton Inn, I think, next to the Children's Hospital. Because we, only parents can leave those whose children are sick in the Children's Hospital. And I think Don made some kind of arrangement that we can also stay in that hotel while we were working in his lab. But it was good. It was good. And he came to Illinois a couple of times. And Jimmy was there, I think. Jimmy, do you remember?
Yeah. We invited him for
Talbot lecture.
Right.
So Taher, that's happened in what kind of period of your career? Like 10 years ago?
No, in 2001, 2002, that was before my tenure.
That's really early.
Yeah, but I didn't go into detail much.
Last year, you're muted. Unmute yourself.
Oh,
Glacio.
Hello.
Good to see you.
Scott.
Oh, hello, everyone. Good to see you.
Hi, everybody.
Hi. Hi, Glacio. Hi, Scott.
Scott.
How's the summer?
Good, good. So far, so good.
Oh, good. Yeah.
Yuhang, my talk today is I spent a lot of time preparing it, and I wanted to have some flavor of some of the discussions we had been having, and some of the comments even made by Glacio and many of you. So it has some hint on societal impact type of thing. So I had, if time permits, towards the end, I may talk about some of the recent work that we have done on masks. And you know, Yuhang Huang mentioned that, you know, we pick up problems that have impact, and this is a very practical, very down to the earth type of problem. And I realized how people can get benefit out of it in hours or days. So I will keep it at the end.
Yeah.
If time permits, we'll talk about it. And this brought me very close to common people. I have never felt this way.
Yeah.
People calling, you know, people, elderly people calling or emailing me and getting some guidance how they would use the mask, and a very, very humbling experience.
Yeah, Taher, I saw the advertisement from CNN.
What's that?
Lab. I see you on CNN. Lab.
NBC.
NBC, okay.
Yeah, that was NBC. Yeah. And what came out from this is that, you know, I think we may need to do something very practical, but that may help people a lot. This was a very humbling experience for me. So again, if time permits, I left one bullet in my outline to cover that if possible.
Let me ask you, Yuhang, something. Yuhang, can you turn on your chat box? Chat box,
yes.
At the bottom, please turn on and send me a message so okay. So we should, we should start soon.
Okay.
Yeah, I just noticed that we have 10 people, 10 panelists over here. 5 of them have Illinois connections.
Yes.
Yeah.
4 or faculty member are still, Taher still, you still are a faculty member. Mm-hmm. 1 was a former student.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. And Yuhang came multiple times to Illinois anyways, right?
Yeah.
Was like my mentor. Yeah. And Scott came too.
Yes, I came too. Thank you.
Taher, you probably want to share your screen now.
Share my screen.
Yeah, Yuhang, it's you're in charge.
Yeah. Yes, thank you, Jigang. Yeah. So today is my great pleasure to introduce my former colleague and mentor, Taher. And Taher is a very top-notch scholar in mechanics and materials field. He received his bachelor degree from Bangladesh University of Engineering and Technology, master's from Washington State University, and a PhD from Cornell University. We just talked about it with theoretician Herbert Hui, and he then worked as a postdoc in electrical engineering and the National Nanofabrication Facility in Cornell. He then joined the Department of Mechanical Science and Engineering at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign in 1997. He is currently the Edward William and the Jim Marr Goodsell Professor in the department. So Taher is one of the few researchers that made fundamental contributions in both hard materials and soft materials. In early years, he made fundamental contributions to the understanding of electrothermal mechanical behaviors of nanoscale metals and semiconductors. And then we also talk about that Taher expand out and gradually shift to study soft living materials. And his research expands to like cancer tumor microenvironment, mechanics of neurons and cardiac cells, and development of biological machines and materials. And I believe Taher is going to tell us even newer things that I have not seen before today in his talk. His work is well recognized in the field. He's a recipient of ASME Equator Medal. And in the past few years, I was very fortunate to have many opportunities to interact with Taher. He's an incredibly talented researcher and always a deep thinker. His work is hypothesis driven and very inspiring in the field. So with that, I will pass it to Taher.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Yuhang. Good to see you. Brings many good memories while you were at Illinois. So today I have changed the title just a little bit. Original title was Living Robots. Today I made it to Emerging Living Robots / Machines. They're sort of synonymous. And this work came from the funding from National Science Foundation from a center. The center name is Emergent Behavior of Integrated Cellular Systems, EBICS for short. And this is a collaboration between University of Illinois, MIT, and Georgia Tech. The students and postdocs who contributed are Brian Williams, Xing Tan, Piyush, Bajaj, Sandeep, Anand, Onur, and Jingwei Li. And the collaborators are Rashid Bashir, Jun Kong, Roger Kam, Steve Stice, Mattia Gazzolo, a mixture of Illinois and MIT. So before I begin, for the last few days, I have been thinking, what are these machines? What have they done for us? And I grew up in Bangladesh, and I came for graduate studies only in the US. And my mom was an avid reader. So she would read books and newspapers whenever she gets time. But I also realized as I was growing up that, she was busy with cooking and cleaning the dishes and washing clothes. So most of the day were gone by doing this kind of work. Whatever time she would get, she would read the books and read to us and so on. So when I came to US, I realized why my screen doesn't move. Let's see. I realized that my mom could have saved a lot of her everyday time by using these machines, household machines like dishwashers and washing machines, dryers, and so on. That would save a lot of her time to do things that she would like to do. So, this is the effect of machines of today, or modern life. And if you move more into it, we know that in industries, there are machines or robots in the manufacturing companies large scale manufacturing are done by great extent by these robots. And of course, we are familiar with the industrial machines or farm machines that have replaced plowing by animals and human beings that I used to see back in Bangladesh. So what these machines did is increased productivity and freed up people to do other things, more interesting things. By washing machine and dishwasher, it freed up, you know, large population among the women population to do things that they're interested at and proceed with more advanced jobs. So in a way, if you look at what these machines did over the time, this is the GDP in per capita in England. What I noticed here that, you know, the GDP was more or less constant up until the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, which started around 1800 and spanned up to about, you know, 1870s or so. Sometimes people call it the second Industrial Revolution towards the end. But what you notice is that the GDP increased significantly, at least in England. Of course, people can argue that there, at that time, the British had the empire and resources were coming from different parts of the world as well. But if you look at the world GDP, it has a similar trend. Of course, the developing countries were benefiting later on in time, but nevertheless, most of Europe and North America, they were getting fast rise of the GDP per capita, but triggered by a great extent by the Industrial Revolution, technological developments, and so on. So when we were growing up, we always had this notion that if population increases, then it's a bad news. Because, you know, the Bangladesh is a highly populated country. And the thought was if population increases too much, then there'll be limited resources and people would just not get enough resources to live, to eat, to survive. So you have to go for massive scale population control. So during the Industrial Revolution, while the GDP was increasing so fast, the question is what happened to the population growth? And to my surprise, this is what you have. Beginning again around 1800 and so on, the rate of change of population growth significantly increased. So again, when we were studying economics in college, there was something called Malthusian trap, which provided the notion that if you increase the population, then you would face starvation and then population will go down. So there's a point where this population growth intersects with this survivability curve and you cannot exceed this. So this is the Malthusian trap, commonly known as. But it turns out that the world survived very well, way past the Malthusian trap. So nowadays this theory is partially discarded because the data does not support the trap itself. And one of the ideas was that, yes, the GDP was growing fast, but at the same time, the population was increasing. So basically, the technology allowed sort of breaking out of the Malthusian trap. So while the GDP was growing, the population was growing, the technology created new opportunities and created new jobs. It did not take away the jobs. So if my mom had dishwashers and dryers and so on, it would not be the case that she would be out of work, but she would get something else to do. And that's exactly what is happening in countries like Bangladesh, where many household helpers who were doing this kind of work, menial work, dishwashing and so on, now they are working more and more in garment industries, more industrial infrastructures, and the houses are getting these machines to take care of everyday work. So the idea here is technology, the machines that are coming into our society in the long span of time has created new jobs, new opportunities, new innovations, and increased in GDP. So the question is, what new technologies can come and help us out? So towards that goal, I thought I bring these are the topics I want to cover today, the man and machine, breaking out of the Malthusian trap that history tells us or teaches us. And then we look into some of the newer machines which are still in the labs and maybe change the way we live in the future. And then I want to bring back to a notion that we in academics, we dream for the future, but we may also think about how to cope with the present in urgent scenarios, like what we have now, and some future outlook. So the machines that are, let's call the machines of the future, one being more advanced robots, one is the MIT's Cheetah project, and the other one is the soft robotics that many of you are already working on, soft materials being involved, and actuation is done by different means. In this case, it could be pneumatic actuation. So I'll play a quick video of the MIT's Cheetah. It's a fairly complex machine, large machine. And I'll have to jump a little bit. So this is sort of the trajectories of the motion of this cheetah robot. And what you see is it can sense an obstacle. And can move through the obstacles quite efficiently. And turn this off, get back to the. And in case of the soft robotics, so what you saw was all hard materials, lots of sensors and actuators. And in the soft robotics domain, this is from George Whiteside's lab. So this is all made from. So this is mostly done by pneumatics. Grabbing an object, moving an object. So I'll stop again. Back. So these are things that might be coming in the future, more advanced. On the other hand, there are also efforts of bringing live cells and machines together. Here are some examples where living cells are interfaced with soft materials. Again, part of it from the George Whiteside's lab, Kit Parker's lab. What they have done is they have plated heart cells, cardiomyocytes, in an organized way, in a patterned way, on soft substrates, BDMS substrates. And then they applied electric fields or light actuation to actuate them to move from one place to the other. So what you'll see here in this video is the cardiomyocytes were plated in a patterned line on this PDMS substrate. Electric field was applied at 1 hertz and it's working on a substrate. And in this case, this is a stingray, also cardiomyocytes plated on a substrate, and it was plated along lines of patterns. And then these are optogenetic, so when light is shined, then the cardiomyocytes contract and you can get the locomotion. So what we thought was taking a slightly different approach. What we realize is all the machines that you have seen, however complex they are soft machines, even with hard cells, what we realize is they don't self-emerge. So they have to be they have to be assembled in a way that you have to design and assemble them, or you can plate them in a certain way and then actuate them. So they cannot self-emerge, they cannot be by themselves, they cannot become themselves. And of course, they don't have the consciousness. So can we think of machines where these living cells can interface with engineered substrates and self-emerge into something that is useful. In the long run, can we imagine that intelligent machines can emerge from live interactions between cells and the substrates? So the idea is the following. So if we take soft scaffolds, and if we take living cells or cell clusters, if we join them together, if we add them together, and if cells interact with one another, as well as with the substrate, then is it possible then through the interaction between the cells themselves, as well as cells and the substrate, new functions emerge, new shapes emerge, new forms emerge. And if so, then they might become functional without assembling, without putting them on a patterned substrate. So the question is it at all possible to have this self-emergence through the interactions between cells as well as cells and the substrate that we provide? And the cells could be neurons, could be muscle cells, could be other type of cells, which allows us to think about maybe long-term formation of intelligence, have some kind of cognition or ability to memorize or remember. So to put it in a more simplistic term, if you think of a simple engineered scaffold, and if we put cells, they could be engineered by genetic modifications. And let's say we put them randomly on this engineered scaffold. Is it possible that the cells could self-organize by themselves without external patterning? And then they become functional by achieving certain desired properties. And then that properties would give rise to a unit which has this prescribed function. So in other words, can order emerge from this chaotic distribution of cells, or can order emerge from disorder? Is there a disorder to order transition possible? So that was the goal. So if so, I mean, one question could be that why would you care for such a thing, even if it happens? Well, if so, then one thing in the existing robots, which are hard robots or even soft robots, you have the actuator, the sensor, and the power source. They're all separate from one another. So the battery is here, and the sensor is there. Actuator is another place, and they all have to work together, wired together. But if we can achieve a robot that is made from cells, then we know that the sensors, actuators, power source, they're all together. They're all in the same cells. They're all co-located. So we don't have to carry additional units. They are all built in. And these machines might achieve autonomy. So we don't have to control them from the outside, if that is possible. And these machines might be highly efficient, because most biological systems are extremely efficient. Like, you know, our brain works with only 100 watts and offers enormous amount of functionality, much more than what a supercomputer does. It memorizes, it, you know, makes decisions, complex thoughts, and so on, only on running 100 watts, where a large computer takes megawatts of power. So maybe these kind of machines may allow a lot more the new functionalities and capabilities that the current methodology of making robots may not allow us to do so. So that's sort of the big picture vision. Now the question is, can we test some of these ideas in the most simplest platforms? So if we want to have some machines, we need to have some actuation. And we thought, well, cardiomyocytes that others have used could come handy right away to offer actuation. We know they contract, they generate quite a bit of force that run our heart. So our first biological machine was with heart cells. And first question then becomes that if we want to make the heart cells randomly placed on a substrate, then how will they work? Will they work at all? So when we started this work, we knew at that time from physiology that there is a problem. And the problem is the heart cells would need to be connected to one another through either gap junctions so that the ions can transfer from one to the other, or through fibroblasts, again, through which ions can transfer. So they have to be physically connected to these junctions. But we want them to be placed randomly without junctions on a soft substrate. Will they work at all? And then the question that we raised at this time is, if they are disconnected without gap junctions, how far they can see each other, a neighbor, and can they interact mechanically alone? Because the only thing left is mechanical now, which is a soft substrate. And if so, then what is the range of interaction, if at all? So our very elementary experiment was the following. So if you take live cardiomyocytes and if you put them as a separate cell, then they stop beating after about a day or so, but they're alive, but they just don't beat anymore. So this is a cardiomyocyte cell, a rat cell. It's not beating. So the question is that, is it possible that if I apply mechanical stimulation on the cell, can the cell wake up? So to apply the mechanical stimulation, we take a probe, contact the substrate, which is a PA gel substrate, a soft substrate. The cell is sitting here, attached to the substrate, and we pull the substrate using the mechanical probe, tungsten probe, which we know doesn't apply electric field, doesn't apply chemical fields, it's only mechanical. So when it pulls back and forth, there's a strain field that generates under the cell. And what you see here, the red lines are the is the actuation from the probe, and the blue lines is when the cell begins to beat. So you see the cell starts to beat, so cell wakes up after a few cycles of mechanical strain, it's about 2.5%. So what we drew a conclusion was a quiescent cardiac cell can be excited to beat by mechanical stimulation alone. It doesn't need chemical, it doesn't need electrical field. Well, that was an important conclusion to draw, because one can think of the following scenario. Now comes the mechanics, that if we think of a cell, two cells, neighboring cells with respect to one another, if a cardiomyocyte happens to contract, producing a dipole, then simple mechanics, Bosinek's theory tells us what would be the corresponding strain on a nearby region. And so it is inversely proportional to the stiffness of the substrate. And of course, inversely proportional to the gap between the dipole and the next cell. So further the cells are apart from one another, the less is the stretch underneath this cell, and stiffer the substrate, the less is the influence between one another. So this dipole force, the effect of the dipole decreases as this curve shows with the distance. So it's like a trampoline. When child jumps on the trampoline, then another one nearby can feel the neighbor because the floor of the trampoline is bouncing back and forth. In the same way here, if this one contracts, this one would feel the stretch. And based on the experiment that I just showed, where the probe was pulling the substrate, making this cell to wake up. So it is possible that the two neighboring cells, without having gap junctions, could wake the neighboring cells up, and then that can continue with respect to one another. So to see this possibility, we plated cardiomyocytes now on soft substrate. And in this soft substrate, they are disconnected from one another, but they are nearby. And the question we ask is, how many of these nearest neighbors beat together for how long? Remember that they don't beat after about a day or two. And in this experiment, the most important plot that you have here is the blue line. So the blue lines or the blue histograms is the behavior of the cell. In other words, how many pairs are beating after 4 days? So by day four, what's the behavior of the cell in terms of the nearest neighbors? So it turns out that if the cells are within 10 microns apart from one another, 5 to 10 microns from another, after 4 days, 100% of them are beating. But beyond that, after 4 days, they're not feeling each other's presence and none of them are beating. Beating together, that's the point. They're not beating together. So when I first presented this data some time ago to a cardiologist, and he said, well, I don't quite trust this data because you're really close by. It's 10 microns, it's not too far. So maybe they have junctions, but you don't see them. And hence you see them beating together. Well, we come from mechanics. Remember, mechanics tells us that if I increase the stiffness of the substrate, then effectively I'm increasing the distance between them. So the cells could be same distance apart, but if I increase the stiffness, then they should fall apart in terms of their communication. It's like jumping on a trampoline, but the trampoline has become so stiff, then the child jumping in one point is not communicating information to the nearby child. So to counteract the argument from the cardiologist, we carried out the same experiment, but simply increased the stiffness of the substrate. So this is the day three, day four scenario within 10 microns distance between the cells, and none of the pairs are beating anymore. So it's not the distance too short and they're connecting somehow that we don't see. It is the effect of the substrate that has become so stiff that contraction of one is not felt by the neighbor, and hence they are not coupled anymore. So essentially this cardiomyocytes are behaving as weakly coupled oscillators, and one contraction is felt by the other, and I will go in a little bit more detail soon, and they interact with one another just by mechanical strain fields that each one produces. So it's like, you know, when I was a grad student at Cornell, I had a family nearby and they had a twin. So this one of them would wake up 2 o'clock in the morning, start to cry. And then soon after, the other one would wake up and start to cry. And then the two would keep crying until 5 o'clock in the morning. And I changed my schedule. So I would also wake up at 2 o'clock and start working and then go back to sleep later in the morning. So it's like one making the other one wake up and then the other one preventing the first one from falling asleep. So they're just continuously beat in this case, or cry in this case. So what we learned from here is that this mechanical signal or strain field from one cardiomyocyte to the other can make a whole population begin to beat synchronously. So to test this further, we plated cardiomyocytes on a PDMS substrate, which is of course stretchable. And this is it's like a membrane. Now this is like really a trampoline, but the trampoline is moving horizontally now, not vertically up and down. The cells can contract in plane. And what you see here, the blue line is the deformation of the membrane. So the cells are not perfectly uniform. So there is asymmetry. So there is a net deformation in one direction. And the green is the beating of any of the cardiomyocytes. So you can see the blue and the green are synchronous. That's because all the cells are beating with the same frequency. And hence the overall dynamics of the membrane is the same as the individual cell dynamics. So the video that you'll see here is the looking from the top, whole membrane is moving in one direction. That is that was the blue curve. And what you see are some of the cells are beating and they're completely synchronous with respect to one another. So if you look at their phase gap between them, so by day two, some of the cells are beating on their own, so there is a phase difference. By day three, day four, they're all beginning to converge to a single phase. So they're getting phase locked. So they're essentially becoming a single actuator through this weak coupling. If I disconnect the coupling by mechanically cutting off the membrane, so it's the same membrane, you can see there's an incision here. Now this group of cells are disconnected from this group of cells. So they don't communicate with one another. And so this group of cells are beating together, but they're not beating with the same frequency or in the same phase. So they're now disconnected. So what is happening here is So every single cell has several ion channels through which calciums get in and get out. And so there is a balance of calcium dynamics within a given cell. So if a cell contracts, then the neighboring cell, so in this case, this cell is contracting, the right-hand cell is contracting, and that makes the left-hand cell stretch. And as the left-hand cell stretches, it has stretch-sensitive ion channels. There are a few of them known. Some of them are being used for hypertension, controlling the hypertension. So these stretch-sensitive, some of the stretch-sensitive ion channels may allow calcium from the media to get in. And as that happens, the internal calcium concentration changes. So for cardiomyocyte, there is a threshold calcium concentration above which there's a large influx of calcium from endoplasmic reticulum, that's in body inside the cells. They release a huge amount of calcium that makes the cell to contract. And then that calcium release is then resorbed, and that's when the diastolic phase comes, so the cell begins to relax. So when a cell contracts, it interferes the neighbor by interfering the calcium level inside the cell by opening the stretch sensitive ion channels. And hence that cell begins to interact, having this new, having this perturbed calcium dynamics, which can be mathematically modeled by considering the strain field of one with respect to the other. And this is a standard calcium dynamics model. The calcium, some of the reserve calcium, some component is the random component and so on. But all we added is this mechanics driven component. And if you do so, then you can model how the dynamics would evolve in terms of beating of a group of cardiomyocytes, initially beating randomly, but then interacting through these mechanics or the strain field with respect to one another. And eventually they begin to beat in synchrony, and they'll be all firing at the same time. I'll just forward a little bit more. So now they have become synchronous firing pattern. So what this means is that they have become a single actuator. That's the point. So what we learned is this neighboring cardiomyocytes can beat as coupled oscillators, and this coupling is mechanical to deformable substrates. Their frequencies converge and they can become phase locked. Now in nature, this convergence of frequencies or coupling between oscillators is quite common. One is fireflies often fire all at the same time. And this is typically found in the banks of rivers in Thailand. And this is a video I thought quite interesting. This is the Millennium Bridge when it was opened in London some years ago. And many people were walking on the bridge. And you can see the bridge is beginning to shake a little bit. And then it looks like everybody's dancing in synchrony without knowing each other. And that's when the bridge was closed. Another example, which is my most favorite and a typical physics example, is the synchrony among pendulums, oscillators. So if you take a set of oscillators and then let them beat, they're beating on their own. But if you do this on these coke cans, then they begin to communicate the motion of this platform. Basically, they're transferring kinetic energy from one to the other. They become weakly coupled oscillators. And now they have synchronized their dynamics. And if you take them off here, you decouple them now. And if you fast forward with time, they lost the coupling and they have become, they're on their own. So this coupling between entities, mostly moving entities, can give rise to this large scale, very large scale morphology of structure. This is fish schooling. So the rule they follow, the fishes follow, is they all swim in the same direction, or more or less in the same direction, and they maintain a gap between them. So they don't go too far, or they don't come too close. So that gives rise to this fish schooling. As I understand it, it is one way to fool the sharks that come to fish them or eat them. And when the shark comes, this pattern breaks apart, and basically they end up with just a few. So this is a defensive mechanism. In case of birds also, you can see similar patterns. Okay, so coming back to the biological machines, what we have learned is this cardiomyocytes can communicate with one another as weakly coupled oscillators, and they become a single actuator. And this is important for making a machine out of it, because if the oscillators are, if the machines, if the actuators are randomly beating, then we don't get any net motion out of it. So once we understood this process of weakly coupling them, then we thought we'd proceed with making a swimmer, and particularly making a small scale swimmer. And at that time I had very little understanding of small scale swimmers. So we started to look into literature, one being from Purcell. He coined the term scallop theorem. I think this was a lecture he gave at MIT some time ago. And the scallop has one hinge and it continues to open and close. And as a result, it has no net thrust. And so he coined this as scallop theorem. But then he proposed this construction with two hinges. And he mentioned that you can coordinate the motion of the two arms in a way which is now called time irreversible motion. Then in low Reynolds number scenario, you can have a net motion from the structure. He gave this problem to the graduate students to solve at home. And he said, you know, you can do it at home. It took quite some years for really formalizing it. And Howard Stone published it, I think, many years later in JFM. In the same lecture, he talked about flexible ore that is done, used by sperms and many other bacterial cilia, as well as the corkscrew motion, where the cilia is turned like a corkscrew and you can get the net motion. So this is a video which uses the flexible ore dynamics, where the sperm is creating this wave, and as the wave goes by, it gets the thrust from the liquid, which moves the sperm to move forward. So it can only happen when there is this time irreversible dynamics where the thrust comes from the wave going back and the liquid pushes it forward. There are examples of screw motion as well as this this twisting motion. This is, I think this was done at Max Planck. Here the magnetic twisting is done on these screws and they can swim in the fluid. And this was done at Howard Stone lab where these magnetic particles were connected by DNA, and by external magnetic field, you can create these time irreversible motions or dynamics, which makes them move forward. So you get a net thrust forward. So you have to apply an external magnetic field to move them forward. So for us, we thought, how can we get time irreversible dynamics from cardiomyocytes working in synchrony with one another when they're plated randomly? So the first thought was, how about making a very small tail in terms of diameter? And we plate the cardiomyocytes, and even if they are separated from one another, they can contract and they would eventually beat in synchrony. That's what we have learned so far. So we don't have to plate them in a specific way. We just randomly plate them and see what happens. At least we know that they should behave as a single actuator over time. So if they do so, then there'll be this bending motion and we might be able to get swimming motion out of it. So this was our first try. These triangles have no significance. It's just to point this, it should be heading this way, but it has no other significance. So this was about 10 micron wide and about I think a millimeter or so in length. And we plated cardiomyocytes all over the tail. And this is what we get. So as expected, all of them are beating at the same time, and hence you get this large-scale motion or twist or bending, but it doesn't go anywhere. It's stuck. So the reason is we are trapped by the scallop theorem, because all it is doing is opening and closing, and there is no net thrust or net motion of the tail. So we thought we need to be a little bit more careful. So that's when we went to model the system. So the modeling is the following. It's basically using the slender body hydrodynamics, low Reynolds number. Everything is linear. So Navier-Stokes becomes the Stokes equation. So here we take the net effect of all the cardiomyocytes as a single dipole, because they would all beat at the same time. So it produce a single dipole. They would create a moment, and that would bend the tail. So we can write down the equations in the x and y direction. So this is the equation in the y direction. So the left hand side is the liquid drag. So yt is the time derivative of y motion, and this is the elastic restoring force, and this is the moment that is being produced by the dipole. So this is the force balance in the y direction, and this is the force balance in the x direction. So it turns out in the x direction, there is this term, which is the drag orthogonal to the tail and drag along the tail, and along the length of the tail. And the difference between these two would result in a drag. It turns out that if you think of a pencil, and if you move the pencil along the transverse direction, then the drag is twice that of if the pencil is moving along the horizontal direction, which is, so the transverse direction is twice the longitudinal direction. So that gives rise to a non-zero drag difference or drag coefficient difference, and essentially giving rise to a net thrust along the tail direction. So this thrust is balanced by the net resistance along the total length direction, and that gives rise to the motion. So here it's just solution of this problem with this boundary condition, zero moment, zero shear at the ends. And at least in theory, you can predict that the motion should happen as long as the cardiomyocytes is located in one region, not all over the length. Because in all over the length, they produce the scallop type behavior. So based on this model, we can optimize the design. So now we can think of what should be the length of the tail, what should be the length of the head, so that we get maximum velocity, maximum speed. And so based on that, we come up with a design where we plate now cardiomyocytes only in one region, which means that all we have to do is when we plate them randomly, we want to make sure that the glue that takes the cell and attach them to the tail is only in this region. And this part is free from glue. So the cells are attaching, they are behaving in single actuator as expected. And now if we detach the tail head from the support, then we should see the dynamics. So again, before I show the video, the theory predicts that this should be the average speed, the slope is the average speed, which is about 10 microns per second, 11 microns per second. And from the experiment, we see the blue line, which is about 10 microns per second. And this model has no fitting parameter. It is just the viscosity of the fluid, the frequency of the cardiomyocyte actuation, and so on. So now if you look at the video, this is the motion of the swimmer driven by cardiomyocytes, no external actuation. These cardiomyocytes plated randomly, sort of in a chaotic way. So what they have done is they landed on the tail. They became weakly coupled oscillators. Now they feel each other's presence because of the motion of the tail. So they emerged into a single actuator with a single frequency. And they are also, which I will not cover, they also aligned themselves so that they can apply the maximum contraction. So they became aligned along the longitudinal direction of the tail, all by themselves, by interacting with the substrate. So they're interacting with the substrate, the tail, as well as interacting with one another, through which, through these interactions, they have become a single actuator and making the swimmer to swim without any external stimulation. So it has become an autonomous machine, emerging into this machine that is a swimming in this case. So now we thought that, well, it's a slow swimmer, so if you can, is there any way to expedite it? So we thought if we can put cardiomyocytes on opposite sides, then maybe we can have a higher wavelength or higher amplitude of the wave that is going by, and that might cause increased speed. So we have not done this experimentally, but we have done in model. And in the first case, we intentionally made them not feeling each other's presence by taking out the strain coupling term. And what you see is they are beating sort of randomly, and the speed is very, very low. Whereas in the second case, we keep them feeling each other's by transferring the strain from one another. So we kept the strain term, the coupling term, and that gives the speed, which is about, at least in theory, about 250 meters microns per second versus 34 microns per second. So it's an order of magnitude higher speed one can achieve. We have not done this experiment. It's quite difficult, but at least in theory, that's what we can expect to happen. Now, we have also done, together with Bashir's lab, also has applied the same cardiomyocytes randomly plated on walkers. And instead of swimming, they achieve also synchronous firing pattern, and they can walk along the substrate. Now, the cardiomyocytes have no hope of intelligence because there's no neurons involved. What we learned is that they can coordinate with one another and emerge into an autonomous machine. But if you want to go towards intelligence, then we need to involve neurons. And the idea here is if we can plate the neurons on the swimmer, and if we can make muscles, and if the neurons innervate the muscles, and if they all coordinate such that they emerge into a self-firing pattern. So this was, I told my student, this is impossible. This will never happen. We talked to Roger Cam, and Roger said, well, do whatever you like. We are the PI of the EBICS. So we started the work anyways. So first, how to make a muscle. So we can put muscle cells around this tail, and we hoped that they would form a muscle strip. So by that time we knew Christian did this swallowing work. So he plated fibroblasts on two pillars and mixed with some extracellular matrix. And what he found is that the fibroblasts compact the extracellular matrix and forms a tissue. So we thought, well, if Chris can do that, we can do that with muscle cells. But when we started to do this, we realized that sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. But this working seems to be dependent on the density of the cells we plate, which kind of makes sense, but we didn't fully understand what might be the underlying mechanism. So we did some thought experiment that what could be the reason for sometime working, sometime not working, particularly when it is density dependent. So imagine the following scenario. So we have these muscle cells now, not cardiomyocytes, the muscle cells. And if each cell begins to change the microenvironment by remodeling it, and if they're far apart, then the remodeled zones would not see each other. So they would all maintain the global symmetry. It's like many, many entities, they're doing their own thing randomly without talking to each other. But if they begin to come closer, then their remodeled zones would begin to overlap with one another, and that would break the symmetry. And once the symmetry is broken, then they can begin to approach each other and compact. So the coordinated activity, the cluster activity can start. So the collective phenomena that can appear in terms of the compaction. So if that's the case, then we thought of taking different densities of these muscle cells and extracellular matrix, in this case, collagen. And we begin to see that they begin to compact and form a tissue. But if they are further apart, then this is also a video, but nothing is really happening because they are not feeling each other's presence. So here, this is the area compaction as a function of time. And of course, when they are close by, when the gap is close by, then they compact. When the gap is further apart, then they don't compact. So if we plot the cell-to-cell gap as an x-axis and the area compaction as the y-axis, this was quite insightful. It turns out that after a certain gap, which is 100 microns in this case, there is no compaction at all, no matter how long you keep them. But below 100 microns, the compaction begins based on some of the concepts that I already discussed. So that was quite intriguing because it seems like there's something like a phase transition where a certain minimum distance, a critical distance has to be there to start the process. So kind of parallels the magnetization process, which is also an emergent property. In case of ferromagnetic materials, one has to go below the Curie temperature and then the magnetization begins. Above Curie temperatures, the magnetic dipoles begin to behave as randomly, so you don't get net magnetization. In this case, above a certain cell-to-cell distance, this compaction doesn't happen. So the parallels here is a critical cell-to-cell gap in contrast to Curie temperature. And in terms of the outcome, one is the magnetization, in other is the compaction. So that left us with the question that what happened to Christian's work? So we go back to Christian's paper. Aha, we find that Christian reported the cell number and the tissue tension that forms after the tissue is compacted. It turns out that his data ends at a point below which there is nothing reported. And this happens to be exactly 100 microns cell to cell gap. So in other words, even with fibroblasts in his lab, he did not find this process to happen, the compaction process to happen below when the cell-cell distance is about 100 microns. So once we know now that what is the critical gap, of course, we can think of making the muscles with cells closer than 100 microns. And now we came up with a platform where we can make, we put the muscle cells here with the extracellular matrix with ECM. And what you see here is now they form this muscle tissue as expected. Now we use cell-to-cell gap is about 50 microns. So they form consistently all the time. And we wanted to head towards neurons, neuromuscular junctions. So in the middle, we played a group of neurons, a bunch of neurons, again, hoping that these neurons will begin to connect with the muscles and form neuromuscular junctions. So this is the neurons, they're shooting out the neurites in different directions. And this is a close view where the neurons are heading towards the muscle in a very organized and non-random way. So in other words, muscles must be sending some signals to the neurons to approach them, and they form the neuromuscular junctions. And what you will see here is that the muscles are contracting as a function of time. Now these neurons are optogenetic, they're modified so that they can be actuated by light. But even before the light was shined, the muscles were contracting. And then when the light was shined for a short time, all the muscles are contracting more or less with the same period. What you notice here is this is the force that we can calculate from the pillar deformations. from elasticity. So the muscles were the neurons innervating or joining the muscles, or contacting the muscles, were making the muscles to fire or contract in a reasonably periodic fashion. And then when the light was shined, they fire more frequently. But then when the light was turned off, they continue to fire in a synchronous way. Which means that in this case, the neurons, by forming junctions with one another, became a neural network. And they are, this network is firing synchronously, which is making the muscles to contract in a synchronous way. And to, of course, we had to check whether the actually neuromuscular junctions were formed. And this is more on the evidence that yes, this was done by the neurons onto the muscles. So looking at the neuromuscular junctions themselves. So once we know now that neurons can become a neural network and can turn on a muscle to fire synchronously, then we can think of moving it towards the swimmer. So here, a group of neurons were plated and the muscles were formed. And this is the actual one. This is a group of neurons. And this is the muscle that was formed with above, with higher density. And again, as you can see, the neurons are approaching the muscle to form the neuromuscular junctions. And this is one when it is formed. And this is when the light was shined and then the muscles begin to contract because the neurons are now firing. And in the next slide, you'll see them when it is released and it begins to move slowly, very slowly, about a micron per second, but it does move. And it moves in the direction that we expected. And then we did the simulations again using slender body hydrodynamics and simulation and the actual deformation matched very well. Again, no assumptions behind the simulations. Straightforward cylinder body hydrodynamics. So in this case, the muscle is sitting here, the neurons are sitting here, they innervate the muscles, they form neuron muscle junctions. The neurons fire synchronously by making neuronal connections with one another. So they emerge into a self-firing pattern, and hence the muscles contract in a periodic way, which makes the swimmer to swim forward. So as I approach towards the end, what have we learned? Is that the crosstalk between the cells at multiple hierarchical scales lead to the emergence of these living machines. So to put it more clearly, so when we plated the individual muscle cells mixed with extracellular matrix, so they interact with one another. And through this interaction, through this crosstalk, they become myotubes or muscles, while the neurons were talking to each other and forming junctions between one another. And during this formation of the junctions, they were approaching a criticality when they begin to fire all together, just like cardiomyocytes started to fire all together. Here, they were firing all together. And as they were forming the neural network, and as it was forming the muscle myotubes, they themselves were talking to each other. This is at a higher level of interactions or crosstalk, which made the neurons approach the muscle in a very organized way. So they were not going all over the place. They were approaching the muscle on a choice basis. And they were not too close to each other. They were about half a millimeter away. So these neurons, which are on the order of a micron in diameter, they were progressing towards the muscle and eventually forming the junction. These are all self-assembled. We didn't program it. We didn't put them in a specific place. We put them randomly. And so through this multi-level, multi-hierarchical levels of crosstalk, what we get out of it is a functional unit that is making the muscles contract in a periodic way, And if it was placed on a swimmer, the swimmer begins to swim forward. So in a way, it is like evolution in vitro, where these machines emerge through this crosstalk between one another. And as the crosstalk emerges, there are many, many metastable states along the way. And it's like the way we view development. Here, this development is happening in vitro. And because there are many possibilities of coming towards the endpoint, if we think of machines that are self-emergent like this, they would never be identical to one another. So it would never be like buying a Mercedes and of the same model, the next one should behave exactly the same way. They would have similar functionalities, but one might be swimming faster than the other. One might have slightly different geometry than the other. So there'll be these variabilities as we have variabilities amongst one another. So ultimate functionality will be similar, but at the expense of the engineering accuracy that we are used to. So the robot that we saw from the Cheetah project at MIT, they should behave the same way one after the other. But here we have to relax that expectation because they will diverge from this very specific bounds of the specifications. Now, if you look forward, what could happen in the future? Can we imagine something like the following? Can you imagine that we might have these kind of machines which may have intelligence, which may have neurons that are trained to respond to specific stimulations, and they could actuate the muscles like we have shown, but they may also carry other cells that could be trained to produce proteins or drugs in response to some desired functions. So for example, could we think of that these kind of small swimmers carry cells which could produce, let's say, anti-cancerous drugs, and they would know what type of protein they would have to produce to act on a specific cancer type, for example. So it's a very long distance view, but with the progress of genetic engineering, one can envision that these kind of robots not only move from one place to the other by sensing some gradients, but also carry other ammunitions with them, which can get activated according to certain rules. So can they produce something that they have been trained for to counteract an event, in this case, maybe a cancer drug that they can produce to fight a particular cancer tumor. So that's sort of the vision that could come maybe in the next century or so. So with that, I will end and maybe take questions.
Thank you, Tahir, for the fascinating talk. So I would like to remind the audience, if you have questions, please press the handshake button in Zoom. So we will promote you to the panel. And once you are already in the panel, if you can, please turn on the video so we can have a virtual face-to-face discussion. And if you have a question after you are in the panel, you can physically raise your hand or press the handshake button. The later is better, so I don't I won't overlook your raising hand. So with that, do we have any questions in the audience? With Siddiq, I saw the hand.
It's a very, very interesting talk. I just like it so much because I'm dealing with this another Science and Technology Center on Engineering Mechanobiology at UPenn. Mm-hmm. And a lot of work just rhymes so well here. I mean, I could see the importance of the substrate, the elastic mm-hmm. properties of the substrate in terms of coordination between these cells. And that center, they basically have discovered that it's not just the, and that's obviously we're talking about, when we're talking about substrate, we're talking about the extracellular matrix also. is transmitting the forces. So they're saying that it's not just the elastic moduli, the viscosity and plasticity of the substrate or the extracellular metrics can be even more important in terms of crosstalk or mechanotransduction. So I don't know if you have looked at that aspect or not, but more than that, I think which is even more interesting is they're claiming that the cells actually have nuclear mechanosensitivity, meaning you can leave the imprint of the mechanical stimuli in the chromatin, in the nucleus, and you can train the nucleus that way to respond to a certain type of mechanical stimuli and get you the emergent behavior that you want. So you may not always need neurons for that. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah. So in our center, we talked about training individual cells so that it doesn't have to be the neurons. You could take even a fibroblast, and you can train by genetic engineering so that you modify their nuclear design so that they can respond in a certain way. Or they could, if you train by repetitive cycles, they might even remember so that they can begin to respond to this training phase. So in other words, if you have what we call the reward punishment training phases, then they would become better and better in doing certain things with respond in response to a certain stimulation. The idea of the neuron is eventually to head towards cognition, eventually head towards consciousness. Because it's known that if you have a certain number of neurons, maybe thousands or hundreds of thousands, then they process information in a much more complicated way. In a way, so they like the way our brain works is many, many neurons begin to fire at the same time. That's why we get this alpha, beta, gamma wave that come out from the brain. And we don't understand this very well yet, but in this criticality of multiple neurons firing at the same time is somehow viewed as the underlying mechanism of memory, consciousness, and so on. So that's why the neurons have these built-in capabilities that we might be able to use in contrast to just other cells. And of course, the mechanobiology will play a role. This in our earlier work, we showed that unless the neurons are under tension, their firing pattern completely changes. So there has to be some built-in tension within the neurons so that they can act according to their functions. So yeah, we thought about training other cells, but the richness of a group of neurons in performing computations and achieving certain consciousness has its own paradigm. Yeah. In fact, we coined the word mind in vitro, which is it possible to have a group of neurons that would have some evidence of consciousness?
Here, can I ask you to unshare your screen?
Ah, yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, that's great.
So I have a question from Jimmy.
Here, beautiful talk, very interesting. I'm glad that EBEX is producing interesting work. The way you use neurons is essentially you use them to pass on the signal.
Right.
There are certainly other functions of neuron sensing. We have sensing neuron, we have action neuron, and so on.
Correct, yeah.
There are functions of neuron which is processing information, which sensing to a certain degree you use because you shine the light on the optogenetic neuron. But the other functions, you haven't really made use of them. Am I right about this?
Absolutely. Many other functions.
What's the future of utilizing these other functions?
That's right. So one function that, it's a very good point, Jimmy, very good point. But one function that we didn't expect at all is the synchronous firing of so many neurons. Because even before we shine the light, you saw the muscles were contracting. And so what I didn't show here is we also put electrodes underneath the neurons and they begin to fire synchronously. There's a bursting patterns of firing. So we thought that they will fire randomly, you know, on their own time and so on. So it turns out that if the muscles are nearby, then muscles must be doing something to the neuron. So the neurons form this central pattern generator, something that drives our heart, the central pattern generator that's firing our lungs. So somehow this functionality emerged. We didn't expect this. In fact, the reason why we chose optogenetic neurons is because we wanted to make them fire on our wish. We didn't expect them to fire by themselves in a periodic way. So there must be some criticality where muscles must be giving them something for which they form these junctions and they started to fire synchronously. And then I think this point of criticality is, or this function is probably central that might lead us to think of doing computations using the neurons.
One of the problems of one of the heart diseases mm-hmm. is the contraction of the heart cells would all of a sudden becomes unstable.
Mm-hmm.
And that requires certain propagation speed
mm-hmm.
of the signal. With your technique, can you identify what the speed of propagation of the signal in your cardiomyocytes
yeah.
or in your neuron construct?
Yeah, neurons are very fast. That would mean probably the patch clamp, as you know. For the cardiomyocyte, it's a little bit easier because we could think of strain gauges, for example. In principle, they are possible both ways, how fast they can communicate with one another. We thought about this for cardiomyocytes because when one cardiomyocyte contracts, the speed propagation is probably the wave propagation of the solid. And you brought up the heart issue. And then it's very interesting because we thought, when we used to talk to the cardiologist, you know, one question always struck was that there are millions of cardiomyocytes in the heart, but there are only few Purkinje cells which are transmitting the signal from the two nodes, sinoatrial nodes, which is at the two parts of the heart. So the thought was that how come so few Purkinje cells transmitting the signal from the two ends of the heart, but how come all the heart is beating? It would be like a transmission line, electric line going by a neighborhood and giving light to only this house and the rest of the house also get lit up. How is this possible? So now it seems that yes, the signal is given to few and they contract. And when they contract, that signal goes to the neighboring cells through the wave propagation speed, which is about 1600 meters per second for the heart tissue. Mm-hmm. So nature must have used this high speed mechanical wave propagation capability of the tissue mm-hmm. and use it. So when people get atrial fibrillation, where the atrial wall doesn't contract very uniformly, and there are little residual vortices that you produce. So people who have atrial fibrillation, they have high risk of both heart attack and stroke. Your mom and my mom, they both passed away having the stroke. So they get atrially fibrillated patients have high risk of 10 times higher risk, 7 to 10 times higher risk of getting blood clots from which they get the stroke or heart attack. So when I talked to the cardiologist, they showed me that those patients, the atrial wall becomes much stiffer. And the bands of cardiomyocytes become further apart from one another because of fibrosis, something that makes it stiffer. So mechanics tells us that once it becomes stiffer, the mechanical communication between one another drops, even though the wave speed might have gone up, but you also need strained field from one to the other. So if they're stiffer, you know, they cannot communicate as well. And if they have become further apart by being filled up by stiffer material, so it's a double hit. So the synchronous contraction is compromised. So it looks like the heart, the high-speed transmission mechanical wave somehow is one of the parameters through which the cells form the synchronous beating pattern.
Very interesting. A lot of mechanics problems.
That's right. That's right. So when fibrosis happens in the heart after post heart attack, the problem is it becomes stiffer. The regions become stiffer, which prevents the mechanical communication between the cells, mm-hmm. right? And many other effects begin to show up. Mm-hmm. So you need the stiffness, but the right amount of stiffness. If it's too stiff, then the coordination may fall off. If it is too soft, then you cannot pump as well as it is designed for.
Thank you. So we have Robin, please.
Hi, Dr. Saif. That's a very interesting talk. Very motivating. So I have a question about the synchronized behavior. Let's say I think they're connected to your later part as well. But let's say I have these cells on the substrate. Mm-hmm. And it's, as you said, it's very much like a phase transition. Mm-hmm. Now I could imagine now if I have some external stimuli to control the stiffness of the substrate from mm-hmm. soft to from stiff to soft, mm-hmm. then I will have sort of a second order phase transition, mm-hmm. random to synchronized. Now the other part is now if I can somehow control the anisotropy of the substrate, mm-hmm. maybe I could have a first order transition. I don't know, I'm just mm-hmm. imagining. Mm-hmm. So my question is, have you experimentally observed any of these? And how about the critical stiffness or curious stiffness of in this situation? Then connected to that, I think the follow-up question is how to effectively model this from a statistical mechanics point of view, or then develop some macro state thermodynamic variable or mean field model based on this?
Mm-hmm. So experimentally, we tested a set of stiffness. We could not do we have not done the gradient of stiffness, if that's what you mean. But what we did is we varied the stiffness and all the cells are on the same stiffness and but the varying stiffness. So of course, as the stiffness goes up, the cells would have to be closer. That's our observation. That's exactly what is predicted by the Bosinus linear elasticity model. Because it becomes stiffer, so they need to be closer. Then we fixed the stiffness, and then we asked the following question, that with the external stimulation, can you make them synchronize faster? So in other words, let's say one is beating at 1 hertz, another one is beating half hertz and 2 hertz. Now you apply stimulation, and let's say we choose 1.2 hertz and see would they converge to 1.2 hertz. So an external stimulation aiding for their coupling, right? That's exactly what happens. So it is almost like the magnetization problem. So is when the Curie temperature, you can shift the Curie temperature by applying an external magnetic field, right? So in this case, if you strain for a certain time, a certain number of cycles, then when they were communicating with one another and approaching towards a certain frequency, you can shift that net frequency to which they were converging to a desired frequency by applying this external stimulation. Now you turn off the external stimulation, they remain oscillating as a single actuator for some time, but then they go back to their intrinsic frequency. So yes, external stimulation not only can expedite their coupling and hence approaching towards the synchronized motion, but you can shift the equilibrium frequency to something else, up to about 50% higher than their intrinsic frequency. Then I realized that when you do exercise, your heartbeat goes up. And it turns out that for very healthy patients, my literature reviews suggest that it goes by to about 2 times, but not more than that. So the heart can start beating more and more and more, maybe triggered by the brain, maybe triggered by other mechanisms, but not too much more than that. And experimentally, we see about 50% higher than the intrinsic frequency that you can induce by external stimulation. Statistical modeling, you asked the question. So I think we have the physical principles laid out, which is primarily the ion channel activity and stress sensitive ion channel. So the ion channels are, they have their probabilistic opening based on a certain amount of stretch. So in other words, you can write down the Boltzmann's distributions for the ion channels and their calcium access or entry. And then you add to it the strain fields produced by each one onto the other in n number of cells, for example, and then let the system evolve. I think that could be one approach. We didn't use too much statistical mechanics. We just allowed one variable, which is a random parameter in the model that I showed, and then added the strain fields from one another. And that leads to the synchronous firing of the cardiomyocytes. The challenge is that there are many ion channels that we don't even know. As far as I know, there are like 4 or 5 that are known stress sensitive ion channels. And they're not very well characterized. So there are fundamental studies that need to be done for complete modeling. Good question. Thank you.
Yeah, next we have Franz Batten.
Hi, Taher, it's a great talk.
Thank you, Franz.
Very interesting. One general question for you. Have you thought about the energy flow in these robots? You know, where does the energy come from? How much work do they do? How efficient are they? Is this something to be at all concerned with? And could you comment on that?
That's right. Yeah. So, David Weitz, when he was visiting Illinois, he asked this question, and to quite a few of us, that do we know how much is the energy that the cell consumes? And how much is the work done by the cells, let's say when they contract the substrate. It's not very well known, Franz. It is, the cell does many things along the way, one of which being the contraction. So it turns out that the efficiency is very low for the following reason. A huge amount of energy is lost just by the drag of the head that you saw. It's just head is doing this without just taking too much energy, but just by moving the fluid around. But other than that, the energy comes from the ATP that the cell is producing by consuming the nutrition from the media. So it has to be nourished all the time. The food has to be there. So it's producing the ATP, and this ATP is going to activate the myosin motors to contract the cardiomyocytes, just like the heart does. But whatever energy it is producing, a big part is lost. That's because of the design we have. I'm sure there are better designs that can be done to avoid this unnecessary loss of energy. And the main source of energy is the nutrition in which they live.
Yeah, you would think because of the thermodynamic conditions that the efficiency has to be fairly low in these systems, right? Given that you're, just think of it as a, any kind of temperature difference is very small, and all these sorts of things that we know about. And right. So, is that at all a concern for future applications, or is the energy consumption so low that you don't worry about it?
Yeah, at this point, the energy overall energy consumption is low. Efficiency may be very low, but at the moment, not really, because we understand so little about these systems already. There's so many other questions. Energy has not been
Have you considered doing calorimetry on these things?
We tried.
Yeah.
The change of temperature is very, very small.
Yeah.
it's a challenge. It's probably less than 0.1 degrees.
Okay, but you can measure something.
Yeah, yeah. So we are designing the probes now where the cardiomyocytes could beat, and we can measure the temperature inside and outside. So initial results look like they could be anywhere between, you know, anything less than 0.1 degree is because they are sitting in a huge sink, right? Yeah. Immediately. So very small change of temperature immediately gets distributed, and the probe itself can cause something the cells would do to start something else, some other metabolic pathway, because the probe would have to be inside the cell. So it's a big question now in the field, that what is the temperature variation, what's the calorimetry for the cells?
You may need an indirect probe to do it, right? So.
Correct. An indirect probe so far is the only way, right? But we are developing a probe where it's like a patch clamp, where there's a connection between the cytoplasm and the probe. Mm-hmm. And that would give us some indication of what's happening inside the cell compared to the outside. Yeah.
Thank you.
Great. Next, Nanshu, you're unmuted.
Yes, thanks. Hello, Tahir. I really enjoyed this is super inspiring and a visionary talk. And I have many questions, if you don't mind.
Sure.
So first, we know that if we can use a pacemaker to actuate cardiomyocytes.
Mm-hmm.
So we can do electrical stimulation instead of optical. And mm-hmm. the benefit is that we can pattern the electrodes so that we can have like electronic controls of mm-hmm. those stimulations.
Mm-hmm.
And my question is, have you considered those kind of stimulation? And if we do electrical stimulation, does that mean we don't have to spend time to let them synchronize?
Right. So the previous works that were done were in this domain, where the cardiomyocytes were patterned along a certain lines, and they apply electric field so that they all contract at the same time. The underlying idea was that the concept of synchronization was still not pursued. So that the electrical stimulation will make them all contract and we get a mechanical deformation out of it. For us, our question was, could they themselves synchronize, right? Through mechanics. Because if we can reach there, then they could be autonomous. And this autonomy is an important part of this living robots. So that's why we wanted to stay away from electrical stimulation. But you're absolutely right. So even when they have synchronized themselves and they're beating, you can apply additional electric field to increase the contraction. Or maybe if they're beating at 1 hertz, and if you want to, you know, make them beat faster, train them to beat in a different frequency, you can apply electric field as an additional parameter to control the system, certainly, yeah.
Right, I see. That makes sense.
Right. And they can, of course, just send the electric signal. So in the pacemaker, what pacemaker does is when the heartbeat drops, then they fire. So the pacemaker continuously monitors that is the firing mm-hmm. coming. And the moment they see a drop, then they pick up and make the heart beat.
Right.
To avoid the supply lack of supply to the brain. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So then, if we want to achieve this autonomous evolution, mm-hmm. My question is: first, how long does it take? And because there are many metastable states, mm-hmm. What if it's taking the wrong route?
Yeah.
And also because it's a living system, so how stable are they as time goes? And do you worry about aging issues?
Yeah, very, very good questions. Yeah. So it's a fascinating question for me that, you know, do they get stuck in a undesirable metastable state, right? So we have made quite a few of them. It turns out, and there is a mystery for us, is that the end game is always reached. The end goal is always reached, which is a synchronous firing pattern and a corresponding muscle contraction and a swimming. So there might be, you can imagine there are thousands of metastable states because each cell is adding to this, to another state, right? But somehow, and this is a probing question, that how they arrived by going to these hills and valleys of energy landscape and somehow they reach there. So there might be a central attractor, you know, if you think in terms of a dynamical system, there might be some kind of a global attractor when they're acting together that ends up being somewhat similar, but not exactly the same. So we never saw scenarios like the neurons approached halfway and not going anymore, or something that caused them to go away to some other place, or the cardiomyocytes not ending up becoming synchronous firing pattern. They always end up there. I think this interaction driven problem where mechanics, the biochemistry, the cell function, the protein expression, they're all somehow, or maybe it is just mechanics.
So I just want to make a comment. And usually people believe this is so-called dissipative structures.
Mm-hmm.
And they have gone through this non-equilibrium processes or irreversible processes
mm-hmm.
to achieve order from disorder.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a natural evolution for any irreversible processes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I guess going from disorder to order is a natural consequence of this dissipative structures.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you're right, yeah. The details of how this evolves, there are many, many players, right? There are many, many players.
Yeah.
And maybe we don't need to look into the details. Maybe this is multi-hierarchical systems where many players work together at a given hierarchical scale can arrive through the phase transition to some next level. The property of the next level is all that matters. Like when the water molecules interact with one another below 0 degrees and they become ice from water. So we don't need to think about how they interacted with one another, but rather we talk about elasticity of ice, the fracture properties of ice. We don't need to go back and see how those properties were linked with the interaction between the water molecules above 0 degrees. The same way when the neurons are interacting with one another, how they went to this phase transition to a synchronous firing pattern, that may be very detailed, but to understand or to use the once they arrive at the synchronous pattern, that property is self-sufficient to understand the system.
But Taher, once this final state is reached, how stable is it? Does it further evolve or does it age?
Yeah. So they do age. So the cardiomyocytes over a long time, and long time could be months. So we had some cardiomyocyte clusters that were beating 6 months later. The frequency goes down. And the amplitude of contraction can also go down. So that's sort of an aging. For the muscles from the C2C12 cells, not the cardiomyocyte, but the muscle tissue, they also age by muscle cells release something called cathepsin. So they begin to degrade the matrix. Probably because once they form the muscle tissue, they are probably waiting for something else to happen. Maybe a neuron coming and forming the neuromuscular junctions, maybe a regular exercise. So it is almost like that when we don't do exercise, when we, when we become sick and we lie down, and then muscle may go through atrophy. So maybe once we form the muscle in vitro, and if they might be waiting for some other signal, and if that is not happening, then autodegradation may take over, and the muscles begin to tear off. So that's the process of aging. So in Bashir's lab, they studied that what chemistry is being released, and they can inhibit that chemistry release, which is, as far as I remember, is cathepsin. And then they make, then you can make them last much longer, right? But this aging is a central question. So it's almost like these biological tissues wait for their functionalities. If that function is not being offered by them, then there is a reverse development, degradation or aging.
To conserve energy, right?
Probably, yeah. Yeah. There's no need to create this tension and remain in the high tension state. They begin to give up, because to keep up the tension, you need to continuously burn ATP, right? Because the myosin motors would have to be continuously pulled, right? ATP has to be burned all the time. So there's no need. Yeah, to maybe to conserve energy, they don't basically choose not to exist anymore.
Wow. I see. And I have one more question. So this multi-scale hierarchical connection from like the ion channel, like mechanical driven ion diffusion all the way to like the axon connection is like well described in this presentation. So we learned a lot from this. And if we extrapolate, right? Mm-hmm. So now we're talking about like cell level and then like aggregate of cell and then probably tissue, yeah. Right? And then organ, mm-hmm. And then like a whole animal, right? Yeah. So is it possible? Like, do you think this kind of hierarchical connection can be fully engineered just in lab and we can like grow something that like we have never seen before?
Oh my God.
It's creepy.
No, there is one central challenge. Has the tissue engineering has not been able to overcome that, which is supplying the nutrition. It's along the line of what France was asking, that, you know, what's the source of energy? Where do they get the energy? So the energy has to come from the nutrition that they collect from the media, right? And one of them, they have to be oxygenated, they have to breathe. So now in the tissue, there is this vessels, the blood vessels, that take the nutrition, oxygen, and reach every single cell, right? So blood vessels become capillaries and smaller capillaries, they're reaching everywhere. In the tissue engineering domain, when the tissue becomes bigger than the diffusion path length from the media, so the media is there and, and you know, the oxygen is diffusing, the nutrition is diffusing, so which is on the order of a millimeter in size. So you don't need the vasculature. You don't need capillaries to go inside and provide the nutrition. So that's a fundamental size scale limit. Mm. Now, if it becomes bigger, then you would need to have those capillaries and stable capillaries so that they can last for a long time. Until now, after about 35, 40 years of tissue engineering, those capillaries have not been able to be formed. So,
but it might be able to be printed.
Yeah, if it is printed, then you have to make sure that endothelial cells remain to form the capillaries mm-hmm. so that they can continue the nutrition. But so far, I mean, you can make a microfluidic system where channels are all inside and the tissue is around. Yeah, that's possible. That could be artificially done. Mm-hmm. But until now, the vasculature has not been able to be reached, grown, right, and stable. I think Roger Camp's lab is the only one, I think, as far as I know, that could keep it stable up to about 2 weeks or 3 weeks. but then they begin to disintegrate. Again, they begin to age. However, if you take the same tissue and put it inside the body in vivo, those vasculatures are very, very good. They immediately form and provide the nutrition to the artificial tissue. And that mystery remains unresolved. That what signal the body gives to the tissue that the vasculatures are formed and they remain formed. But in vitro, that has not been possible. So to answer the question, if the object becomes bigger and bigger, to begin to bring more and more quote unquote organs, so kind of the animal on a chip, then we have to have a way to supply. And I think that's sort of the goal of the animal on a chip program, that can you mimic something with multiple types of organs or cell clusters that all coordinate with one another and eventually become like an animal. Long way to go.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Next, we have a Galasio.
Oh, hello, Taher.
Hi, Galasio.
Very nice talk. Thank you very much. Great talk.
Thank you.
Taher, and again, my question is more a curiosity that is also related to all the previous questions here. And the idea in your living robots of having the actuation sensing and the power source in the same system is quite fascinating, especially the power source, as was discussed here, because it's quite challenging. The curiosity that I have is a statement that you made, and is very clear, that your system is unique. That means you have the uniqueness, but you can also not repeat it. Because it's unique.
Mm-hmm.
Is this an advantage or a disadvantage, Taher? Because I'm trying to make sense out of this. I'm trying to figure it out. Because, for example, you compared in the beginning with hard robots and soft robots. But those always are very predictable. They have a function. They deliver that function exactly, mm-hmm. precisely. And then... The scaling and the use of your systems, like the last slide, in the future, for example, are important factors. So this is the curiosity I have. Is this an advantage or a disadvantage?
probably depends on the application. So if we go for a system, and you highlighted the most critical parts already, where the sensors, actuators, battery are all together. That's one. All the circuitries are done by themselves. We don't have to do it. And they're autonomous, if they can be fully autonomous. That's a huge paradigm shift, right? You produce a system that's supposed to do something, and basically you put the nuts and bolts in a chamber, and they sort of self-organize into this machine, but they disadvantage was that they don't look like identical to one another, but by and large, they're serving a purpose. By and large, they're serving a goal. So you give up the traditional, you know, highly defined specifications, you relax that, but you gain autonomy on the other side, you gain intelligence, and you might even gain more cooperativity, which other systems cannot provide. You might be even getting some kind of cognition, some kind of consciousness that other systems cannot provide. You might be even getting some decision-making by themselves that otherwise you need to have many parameters being put into a supercomputer and giving a decision. Whereas here, they might be making a decision either by being trained over time or intrinsically, biologically, they have these abilities. So yeah, I see your point. You have to give up I want this dimension. I want this speed, or I want this function precisely within a small error of margins, right? I think we cannot have it because evolution will have this multiplicity of metastable states and where the land eventually and continuously evolve with time. Just have to give up with it. I think. I don't think we can.
Hi, Taher. Thank you very much for your wonderful talk. I have a question for you. You talk about the synchronization of cells. Mm-hmm. It's a very challenging problem, actually. Mm-hmm. So are you sure that it depends on the chemical signals and also mechanical interaction between cells? Mm-hmm. Can you give some comments to show how to control this kind of synchronization among cells? Because you only show the synchronization, but how to control the magnitude of the deformation, although also the frequency of the synchronization dynamics. Yeah. How to control? If we cannot control, it's not useful, right?
Right. So the the mechanism of synchronization we can control by controlling the stiffness of the substrate. Mm-hmm. I showed, like, you got higher stiffness, then you have to bring the cells closer. So that part, I think, is more under control. What is less under control is what final frequency they would land, what final frequency they would become. I mean, let's say the intrinsic frequency of cardiomyocyte, maybe let's say 1 hertz, but you might end up being 0.9 hertz, as Giloshi was pointing out, or you may end up being 1.1 hertz, the net frequency of many, many cardiomyocytes. Now, if you apply external stimulation to shift that frequency to something else, by, as I mentioned, if I apply a mechanical stretch, so let's say your target frequency was 1.5 hertz, but you are ending up with 1 hertz, or 0.9 hertz or 1.1 hertz. Then you want to be in 1.5 hertz. So by applying external mechanical stimulation for a certain amount of time, they would all go up to 1.5 hertz. And then you take out the external stimulation, they will remember that they had been trained to go for 1.5 hertz for up to a certain time that we have tested, up to a certain time, maybe an hour, maybe 2 hours, and then they go back to their original frequency or whatever their converged frequency was. So there are tunabilities. You can apply maybe electric field to make their frequency go up to 1.5 hertz for a short time, mm-hmm. Not permanently. Now, to go to permanently, then you need to start genetic engineering. Then you need to make sure that, you know, the underlying time constants of the system, which really depends on the transport of calcium back to endoplasmic reticulum. That's the time it takes to relax the cell. It contracts very quickly, but relaxes over a longer time. So that relaxation time is dictated by the transport mechanism of calcium that was released by endoplasmic reticulum back to endoplasmic reticulum. So if you can genetically modify the cells, then that would be a way to control. Then it slightly begins to go out of mechanics and more into molecular biology. But I think it's possible. I think your idea is in the right direction. We have lots of tools now,
yes,
to engineer cells genetically, as well as from mechanics point of view or otherwise. So there is a broad spectrum of tools we have to change them.
Okay, thank you.
So I have a follow-up question. So I found that I couldn't raise my hands as a co-host. I couldn't find the raise hand button. So Taher, it's always a joy to listen to your talk. It's so inspirational. So many years back, when I first read your paper about this cardiac beating, immediately I thought about this question. So in crystals, atoms are the basic building block, right? Mm-hmm. So we have these molecular dynamic simulations, right? So in which you have to provide the interatomic interaction potential, right? Mm-hmm. So after the publication of your paper, I start think that cells are the fundamental, the basic building block of tissues and organs. Can mm-hmm. we actually establish inter-cell or intercellular interactions,
mm-hmm.
so that we can do this cell dynamics.
Right, right.
So that's my dream. That dream has been like 5-6 years ago. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I found that there's nothing there. Nobody give me any intercellular interactions, right? Mm-hmm. Not mention about how this cell interacts through the soft substrate.
Mm-hmm.
So I started to do some experiments by myself.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then I do these experiments. I have a pair of cells. I say, how they interact with each other? So what do we do in my lab is that I put these two cells very close by, but not touching.
Mm-hmm.
And then I measure the traction force, the mm-hmm. force that's exerted by the cells on soft substrate. And then I kill one of the cells using laser.
Mm-hmm.
And I measure the traction force by the left cell, I mean, by the cells still alive. We did this experiment, 2 years. We couldn't find anything mechanically different before and after I killed the other cell.
Hmm. How close were they?
What?
How close they were?
They are like, the closest is like 2 microns to 3 microns.
Hmm.
Right? I couldn't get any closer because then I'm running into the worry that these cells might have formed junctions.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I get very frustrated. And I see the success of your examples. You have like a cardiac cells, they are separated. You say that they end up with synchronized beating.
Mm-hmm.
And you have a bunch of muscle cells in the dish and then they start to contract.
Mm-hmm.
But I couldn't do this with a pair of cell, which is very fundamental, right?
Yeah.
Any suggestions on that?
Yeah, I think what might cause the beatings synchronize is the dynamics, not the statics. So if you imagine synchronization between weakly coupled oscillators, there is a dynamic component and the coupling component. So if it is a stationary, let's say 2 fibroblasts, there's no dynamics. They're like stationary or very slow dynamics. It's like hours to build the force. So they have reached to a sort of a steady state, but there is no dynamics involved. There is no, so in the cardiomyocyte, they're beating at like 1 or 2 hertz, making the other one expand and contract, and which might relate to the opening and closing of the ion channels. But if it is a cell that is not going through dynamics, then the coupling concept that may lead to some collective behavior probably may not.
But you say the cells are always in dynamics, is always dynamic, right? It's just what kind of time scale you're looking at.
Right, right.
So that's the problem, that if you want to measure a long time scale, mm-hmm. then cell will migrate in a different area.
That's
and
right.
the falling apart is get close, then you cannot mm-hmm. measure that.
So I think the dynamics means in this case, the strain field that each cell is producing. And of course, in the fibroblast, for example, they're also contracting and it is influencing the next cell, but it is so slow process, many, many hours, right? 2, 3, 4 hours to build the force. So in that case, maybe the internal cellular processes are much, much faster. So whether it is ATP burning or migration of the vesicles inside the cell, protein productions, going to mitosis, all those things may be much, much faster. Or all the cellular intercellular process might be much, much faster. So in that case, the cells may not be seeing the very slow dynamics that might be coming from the neighbor. But in the cardiomyocytes, it is beating at 1 hertz. So the internal dynamics is also on the order of a second or sub-second time scale. So they're kind of interacting with one another. It's almost like if you think about the pendulum example that I showed, the metronomes, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you leave the metronomes on a hard table, and there are dynamics happening very slow pace, right? The track going by, or the table might be shaking a little bit, or so they don't really make the energy transfer from one to the other. But moment you put on a Coke can, the table is now shaking at the same time scale as the pendulums or the metronomes. And then that might be interfering their dynamics. But if external stimulus is coming at a much, much slower time scale, then at least that is a simpler example. the cell is much more complex example. But my thinking is, in case of neurons, for example, they're firing at, let's say, 1, 2, 3 hertz or more, right? Now their junctions are formed. So one of them junctions firing, that is being felt by somebody else very quickly. And so that is that time scale of firing pattern of the cells are in the same order as their individual firing patterns. Maybe that's why they're synchronizing. Now I'm speculating. For the cardiomyocyte, I think it's a little bit easier to see, because the moment one contracts, the other one expands, the ion channel opens up, the calcium gets in. They're all happening in the same time scale as the firing beating pattern. Maybe that's why. But if the cardiomyocytes were not beating at all, they're just slowly generating the force. And they're only interacting basically with the substrate. And then whether there is neighbor or no neighbor probably wouldn't matter.
But say in your muscle contracting model, mm-hmm. you say that in long time scale, there is interaction.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The substrate. No doubt about that, right?
That's right, yeah.
So this fundamental question of how a pair of muscle cell interact through the substrate is not resolved. We don't know.
It's not known. It's not completely resolved. Yeah. Yeah. We don't know. Right. And how far is the interactions? It's not. What we know is if there's a gradient of stiffness, then the cells migrate towards a stiffer substrate or the stiffer directions, right?
Also for that, for how I did that, I'm publishing in Science, even for that, it's not a pair of cell, it's a group of cell, it's a collective, collective motion. And by collective, this kind of motion is amplified, or response amplified.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, it's not fully resolved. I fully agree with you, yeah. All we know is there's interactions, but what are the time scales? What are the key parameters? Who are the key players? Who senses the mechanics? And who sends the signal back to the cells? And why, what is the time scales involved? What are the criticalities? I don't think it's very clear.
This is very helpful. You're bringing up this time scale. I think I thought about that, but you know, I probably didn't have enough patience to look too long.
In the community, what happened is, this is my view, is biologists looked at the problem from a molecular point of view. And you and I discussed this, we wrote the proposal together, right? I think there is a group who think about, okay, if I change this gene, what happens? Whereas the macroscopic behavior cannot be answered by looking at the molecular scale. So when we look into synchronization, if you think only from a genetic point of view, a particular DNA point of view, I think this macroscopic behavior, whether it is taking a shape of a tube, of a vasculature, or communication between long distance, I find very difficult to explain if one looks at only from a genetic point of view or a molecular point of view. I think there's this gap in the hierarchy of scales mm-hmm. is a very big gap in mechanobiology and in biology as a whole. As you know, how a tube forms is still an unresolved question. How a vasculature is formed as a development happens, still unresolved. What we know is if you turn off a certain gene, it does not form the vasculature, it does not form the vessels, blood vessels. But that doesn't answer the question that when the gene was there, how did it form? How did the morphogenesis happen? It's unresolved.
Can I add a speculation about that question just very shortly? So in addition to the dynamics and time, how about, so just from a pure elasticity point of view, we know elastic interaction is long range and dipolar.
Mm-hmm.
Then how about you have a pair of cells, two cells together, the interaction is just simply not strong enough, but you have a group of cells, then the elastic interaction is stronger.
0 hours.
Yeah, that's one speculation.
Sure. The strength of the signal is high.
Yeah, that there might be a threshold.
Yeah.
So in biology, threshold is a very important phenomenon.
Correct.
If the system has not reached the threshold, nothing will happen, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that threshold could be time threshold. That threshold could be strain threshold. Yeah. If the slow signal is very slow, then it may not respond at all.
Tom, you have a follow-up question?
No, actually, there are a few people I've been patiently waiting. I can, Glaucio, I saw you were trying to ask questions previously. You want to go first?
I think Glaucio was already asked.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh,
thank you.
So, okay. So I can. Okay. Good. So
yeah, if you can wait, let's maybe Brian and Yong first. Brian, can you go first? Yes.
Hello, everyone. Tahir, that was fabulous. Oh, it was such fun watching you talk about those cells doing their living things.
Oh, thanks.
Marvelous. Yeah, I'm along with Su Lin. I have no raise hand symbol on my screen. Shigang, is it possible that that's because you've made me a member of the panel?
No, it's not. I have never been panel myself. I'm always host. I don't have a hand either.
So the co-host and the host has no hand button. So we have to raise the hand physically. But other panelists, you should find a handshake button on your screen. Click
no,
that.
No,
and,
no. Actually, no. Today,
no.
I'm
not have. It
turns out that Brian, you should go to go to participants, and there's on your line there's one thing called more. If you click more, there's hold on somewhere.
Well,
okay. At the bottom of that, there's a. Raise your hand option, right?
That's terrific. I'm very pleased to hear that it's not a dysfunctionality that's personal to me. So here are the questions. The first one's very simple. When these things pulsate, I don't think you mentioned what the amplitude of the displacement is.
Mm-hmm.
In the heart, it's something like 23%.
Yeah.
I imagine in the heart, the entire heart tissue, including the matrix, moves 23%.
Yeah, it's a large deformation. Yeah.
But you have cells that are on a substrate.
Correct. Yeah.
Does the substrate move or do the cells slide across it?
Oh no, substrate deform. So substrate elastically deform. We get on the order of 5 to 10%.
Yeah.
And it also depends on the stiffness of the substrate. So it's another complex interaction. So if the stiffness is very low, you'd expect the cells would produce big deformation, but then the cell readjusts the forces it produces, so it produces less force. So it turns out that there's an optimum stiffness on the order of 18 kilopascal for the substrate, which happens to be similar to the stiffness of the cardiomyocytes when they produce the maximum energy. So the large deformation and the large force. If the stiffness is harder and harder, of course, then their deformation goes down. Or if it's very soft, then they just don't produce that much force.
Yeah, okay.
So it's a crosstalk between the two always.
Right, okay. And then the second question is this. When these cells assemble themselves, at least the muscle cells form a column, so they must move on the substrate to do that.
You mean the muscle cells, not the cardiomyocytes?
Yeah, right. They were forming some sort of columnar structure.
Correct. So they, in our case, the geometry is such that their motion is restricted by some stops. So they don't, once they form, they're stationary at that location, right? But otherwise they would, yeah.
Right. And so then the last question is, and I think other people have already talked a little about this, but have you got anything else you can say? Some insight into how you would persuade the cells to migrate collectively or to at least assemble themselves by moving spatially. Is that something that you can envisage being able to control?
Yeah, very, very good question, right. So this is part of the self-assembly, what we call guided self-assembly. So far what we have done is we just made everything uniform, but gave the glue where the cells can attach to a specific location. But ultimately, we want to have more guided self-assembly. So in other words, if we can have a gradient of the stiffness so that we make the cells assemble in a certain direction or certain location, in that case, we probably would not have to choose a certain location to make them glued, but we randomly plate. And then through the guided self-assembly, by either changing the stiffness of the substrate, they would move in a certain direction. The migration would be controlled. Right. Mm-hmm. And you can begin to think of different migration patterns so that you can think of even having mixture of different types of cells and then self-segregation of different types of cells. Mm-hmm. So would be another level, another hierarchy of self-assembly or emergent property.
Mm-hmm. And I have a follow-up question on Brian's question, this muscle cells.
Mm-hmm.
Muscle cells divide,
mm-hmm.
right? Mm-hmm. To generate daughter cells.
Correct.
We know that neurons don't divide. They are fixed mm-hmm. numbers. Yeah. Muscle cells divide. But when you form this muscle ring, mm-hmm. when the cells divide, does it change the intrinsic tension in the muscle ring?
Good question. That we have not measured yet. So as the progenitor cells or the daughter cells begin to show up, once they differentiate to myotube, then they are not single cells anymore. So they are like multiple cells forming a myotube. They don't divide anymore. So I think mm-hmm. once they've gone through the differentiation phase, all of them have become part of a myotube, then they're stuck. But there are always single cells that have not gone to differentiation. They keep dividing and the muscle could grow in some other place. It goes back to, I think, Nanshu's question before, that how stable they are and whether they age, whether they grow. So as Sulin says, it's a non-equilibrium thermodynamic problem. Everything is changing.
Interesting.
Yeah, so next we have you ask a question.
Okay, well, thanks. Thanks to Yuhang. Hey, Taher, wonderful talk, very inspiring. You talked about cell-cell interactions, right, through the substrate. It seems to me you focus on the static aspect, right? How about dynamics? Suppose if we can vibrate the cells at a certain frequencies, mm-hmm. then the question would be, what frequencies would be more or almost effective in communicating through the substrate, right? I think I used the analogy of a trampoline, right? So mm-hmm. if a kid is jumping at a certain frequency, close to the resonance frequency of the trampoline,
mm-hmm.
we will see dramatic effect.
Mm-hmm.
So how about the cells here? I don't know, is it possible to have the cells and the substrate sort of beating at the similar frequency range?
Yeah. So we did those experiments, in fact, published in, I think, in Experimental Mechanics. So if you apply the external stimulation on the substrate, you can make the cells move to higher frequencies. Let's say their intrinsic frequency is 1 hertz, If you stretch the substrate at, let's say, 1.5 hertz or 1.25 hertz, you see the cells begin to move at a higher and higher frequency, but not too much more. If you go to 2 hertz, for example, then what you see is for some time, the cardiomyocytes are beating at 2 hertz, and then for some other time, it's beating at 1 hertz. So if you look at the histogram of the beating frequencies, you see a bipolar distribution emerging. So the cell sometimes beat very, very fast, and then sometimes it beats back to 1 hertz, even though you're oscillating at 2 hertz or oscillating the substrate, stretching the substrate at 2 hertz. But up to about 1.5 hertz, they can speed up to 1.5 hertz. And we identified potential ion channels that might get activated during the diastolic phase. So imagine the cell wants to gradually go down, relax, taking about a second, 0.9 second, but the substrate is stretching at a faster rate. It turns out that about halfway through the diastolic phase, there must be some ion channels that can sense the strain. And when the strain is happening at a faster rate because I'm applying higher hards, then during that diastolic phase, the cell wants to contract again. And so we did a detailed analysis of the phase analysis. And it turns out that there must be something which is sensing the strain during the diastolic phase. So then you can tune the frequencies of your substrate such that the maximum strain happens when they're about to contract. Then you don't see that response, but you can tune it in a way that your maximum strain, or the strain rate, I don't remember which one was it, happens at the halfway through diastolic phase. Then you can see the cells begin to speed up. So it depends on what mechanism the cell is using to sense the substrate strain fields. And it seems to me that there is something hiding in the cell that gets activated during the diastolic phase. Relaxation phase.
Okay, I see, thanks. So how about the cell? Does the cell have a natural frequency like in the engineering system?
Yeah, I think so. I think animals, they have a certain frequency. So I think for the cardiomyocyte that we have been dealing with is about 3 hertz. What happens is if you look at the spectral density of the frequencies, then there are also higher frequencies, but they're less and less spectral strength. So if you look at the Fourier transform, you see a strong peak at about 3 hertz, and then smaller peaks at higher and higher hertz, but they die out by about 10 hertz or so. So they have the intrinsic ability to fire at a faster rate, maybe to accommodate when we do exercise and run, but they tend to converge to some intrinsic frequency.
Yeah, Tahir, Siling again. So I want to ask you a very general question at this point. I think it's a little bit late now. You take a drastic step going from solid mechanics to cell mechanics in kind of biology. Any lesson learned from this adventure can be shared with us? And most of the people here on the board are still working on solid mechanics, right? Mm-hmm. Some of them are working on soft matter mechanics. Mm-hmm. Any lesson you can share with us?
I'm still in the mechanics domain. You know, I don't know much biology, as you know. So I look at problems that are more mechanics related, like the type of things that I discussed, right? The strain field going from one cell to the next, the time evolution, the time dynamics. You know, the concepts of weakly coupled oscillators, they're deeply ingrained in mechanics, dynamical systems. Now, of course, the biology comes with richness that always makes me wonder, right? If we take a bunch of cells and look at their behavior, there are always this enormous richness that is very, very intriguing. And you and I discussed many times, it's so intriguing. And I think this element of unknown, we don't know what is the equivalent of Maxwell's laws in biology. We don't know an equivalent of, you know, F equals MA or any other laws that we can. I mean, those laws are there. You cannot bypass them, but there are higher level of interaction laws that very little understanding is there. So I have tended towards more the mechanics part where I could measure things and model simply, right? But it's a challenging area. I mean, it's an interesting area. And of course, you know, there is there's always this risk of moving out from the things that I know to a field that I don't know much. There's a price to pay. There's a long learning curve, and you enter into territory where you don't know many people. My advisor used to tell me back in graduate school that always work in a field where there are more than four hands to clap after you talk. Because people, you would know, like my friends, that you guys are here. But of course, going to these newer fields, there will be people whom I don't know. So it takes a long time. It's a risk. I would not suggest before tenure.
So but you started before tenure.
So this is something that I was wondering. I think it's good to bring this up. I was wondering if Zhigang and Franz have any, or Franz is gone now, any suggestions. I always get a little scared, when we stepped out from our comfort zone on mechanics.
It's risky, but it's very rewarding. It's risky, rewarding. And I think Yuhang Wang mentioned that, luckily we have this job, which after tenure gives us stability and you can take risks. And many things may not work out in terms of an impact, right? Some things may, but on the process, we may learn something that the biologists need to know. And yeah, you may give up some hands to clap, but at the end of the day, we enjoy what we learn.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Taher, why you would not recommend this before tenure? Why not?
Kilashio.
Hard question.
Yeah. I think that I automatically took this advice. I think I started my lab, started the experiment, right? Play around with the cells right after I get tenure, 2011. Because there is also risk that you start a new stuff, very new, and very a lot of unknowns, you know?
Yeah, I have some question about reducing the risk. So you're a young person, very young, and like to take risk. So you're thinking about 2050, there's something. I didn't quite catch what is that something, but among your friends, people you know, and yourself, do you have one or two examples of an application of using cell as actuator? So I can latch onto it.
Yeah. I think that's other than the biobot type of thing. Mm. So I give you a specific example.
Yeah.
So NIH always looks for very specific things that has an impact.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Very practical in some sense. At least that's my understanding. I may be wrong. So what happened is that we know that exercise is important for cognition.
Mm-hmm.
It slows down the memory loss. It slows down the neurological diseases. So now that we have a system where we have a muscle neuron connecting, so the question we asked is that what is the effect of exercise on the muscles on the neuronal activity, mm-hmm. neuronal growth, neural connectivity, and so on. So until now, all we know is when we do exercise, mm-hmm. then we have better cognitive state. People have studied from the blood what is there.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say A, B, C proteins are available. But nobody knows that who releases the protein. Is it the muscle that is going to exercise or is it something else? So the idea of this simple system where neurons and muscles are involved, we can now apply the exercise on the muscle to see what they're doing, whether they're releasing certain chemistry or whether they're releasing exosomes, whatever it is, and then read out from the neuron firing pattern and their connectivities to see what things that the muscles are doing that is good for the neuron. And if we know that, that could be therapeutic, that for people who cannot do exercise, that could be an artificially induced drug or synthetic drug that would provide the same input that the person would have gotten by exercising. But now this person cannot exercise. So that's the NIH project that got funded. So it's a more practical, real life application. On the other hand, once we have an in vitro system where muscle, where the cardiomyocytes have been activated, then you can test different drugs to see the side effect of the drug on cardiac functions. So it's kind of, you don't want to go to animal models because it's too complex. Mm-hmm. You have an in vitro system and it involves forces and actuation. Mm-hmm. And either way, if force is important, actuation is important for cognition, this system allows to understand what did they do to improve cognition or what would happen if I apply certain drug on them. So these are some useful readouts that we can get. Now, if you think of what is the use of a bio robot that is self-emerged, right, completely self-emerged, or many, many of them, how would they behave in a scenario? Mm-hmm. That is still, I think, far-fetched.
I have a question related to soft robots because Harvard is really big on soft robots. I try to understand the rationale. I don't quite really, Anyway, about soft robots. Mm-hmm. So of course, we already have a lot of soft robots, right? My colleague wants to make insects. Mm-hmm. There are already insects, many insects. But it makes me think about the old idea of domestication. Mm-hmm. For example, for many, many centuries, we have been using pigeons to mm-hmm. send letters.
Yeah.
So I can imagine today I can tie a camera on pigeon, then pigeon can take pictures. Yeah. Why do I need to develop another thing that can do just that? For example, another thing is, oh, I want to develop some mouse-like activity to mm-hmm. get information or to rescue some people. I have a lot of mouse. The general, right, general question is a domestication in new age.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In the past, domestication, you do essentially doing genetics modification, genetic mm-hmm. modification, right?
Like
higher level, but yeah. ultimately you act on genes.
Yeah.
So that door become even widely open. I'm sure people are doing that. Mm-hmm. But then you can also do nowadays can do electrical modification. Mm-hmm. So the people already cure diseases mm-hmm. by implanting electrodes in the brain, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And also presumably, I'm imagining, I don't know anything. This is a question I have for you. People also like yourself have all kinds of MEMS devices, mm-hmm. presumably can also be implanted mm-hmm. or into the body. So mm-hmm. let's say if mouse do something right, I encourage it by massage your heart. If you do something wrong, boom, boom. I don't know, you get my point. There are so many new tools previously totally unavailable.
Correct.
To domesticate animals mm-hmm. for mm-hmm. human use. I don't know if it's a politically correct thing to talk about, mm-hmm. But at least it's a scientific question.
Yeah.
Why not we do that?
Yeah, I think that's a broad open field that can mm-hmm. be learned from what we used to do before, maybe 50 yeah. years, 100 years ago.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
can we, now that with the tools of genetic engineering,
yeah.
can take the animals and create a new breed of animals, again, yeah. politics aside,
yeah.
Can this breed of animals can do something that is much more trained to do it in a very, we do it already with the dogs, right? Yeah. The sniffing dogs that in the airports, they yeah. probably do much better than yeah. the silicone devices, right? Because their smell is so strong, they can identify them.
Yeah.
But we could probably use other types of animals to do to things that they would do before. But yeah. in our case, for my long-term vision, which I'm sure not in my lifetime, would it be possible to have these very miniature micron scale mm-hmm. swimmers loaded with cells mm-hmm. that who had been trained either genetically modified or going through the process of training, who would be identifying the problem, who would be identifying, let's say, a cancer tumor. So the neurons and the muscle cells, they would take the swimmer to the cancer site.
Yeah.
And then they're carrying these cells, which cells can produce about 10,000 proteins every day, depending on the need. So there's a huge sensory built-in so that they can produce the proteins of what is needed, can we not make these cells to produce the right chemotherapy at the site of the cancer? Mm-hmm. And if they find that this cancer is of no harm, can they not just do anything? Yeah. And that's the level where the medicine might have been completely transformed. Yeah. Then we are not taking drugs anymore that affecting the whole body, but going to the right site and then giving the cells the ability to produce the drug as needed.
Yeah, I have a question about something more immediate. There is available technology. Mm-hmm. People embed electrode on humans' brain for many years, right? And to cure diseases. So this technology already exists.
Yeah.
So can anybody harvest this technology? Let's say I put in mouse brain. Mm-hmm. I ask mouse, so train mouse enough, mouse find something for me, get information or go some direction.
Mm-hmm.
Seem to be totally accessible to us, can be done now. Is that being done?
I don't think so. Not that I know of, Jigang.
So many soft robots already fully prepared with actuation, sensing, everything. All you need to do is just do a little bit of electrical modification.
Yeah, they're waiting for the task, right? I think it's an interesting idea. It's a very interesting idea.
Yeah.
It could be a whole business.
Yeah. So many different varieties. Nanshu is the right person to do it, right? Well, yeah, maybe start with a humane thing. Start with a fish.
Yeah.
So fish swim to some place.
The military is doing something to, you are trying to increase the intelligence of animals. We know the deep brain stimulation can like help restore memory and cure some diseases. But you're talking about like increasing the intelligence.
I don't know what I'm talking about. For example, I wrote, oh, this dog, learn how to hug, Nansu. Right? Just do that. I think it's
within
our reach. Why not? Do something really useful.
Yeah.
And then through this, of course, you learn many things about a human machine interface.
Yeah.
Right? And then you have immediate object.
Mm-hmm.
You have to think about random things. There are so many soft machines around.
Yeah. In therapeutics, for example, the animals, like pet animals, like in Japan, and many societies, right? Even in the US, those who are elderly, pet animals have been serving a very big emotional support already. But it could be expanded by a great extent. And that those animals could be very small. That could be at the bacterial level.
Yeah.
They could be trained, modified, so that they do something for you. They're already doing things as a part of the evolutionary process. But there could be a new generation that could do something else, more than engineered, basically, engineered bacteria. Right?
So if I may interrupt, I think we still have a question from Hai. Thank you for your patience. Can you unmute yourself?
Yes. Thank you, Professor Hu and Professor Saif for the very inspiring lecture. I may be new to the TML webinar community, so I would like to briefly introduce myself. I used to be a postdoc at Illinois in Professor Hu's group, and I received a lot of help from Professor Saif.
Yes.
And originally I have two questions. Actually, my first question has already been partly answered. That is, how long time can the cardiac cell can beat in vitro? I remember that you mentioned that it can, like the beating can last as long as 6 months, right?
Very long time. As long as you take care of them, they can do for a very long time.
Okay. Yeah, that's my first question. And my second question is that, is there any potential threat for human when the soft robot have more and more intelligence or become even more self-conscious? Yeah, could give some comments on that.
Yeah, that's a big issue. I mean, you know, one idea, I learned from one of George Whiteside's talk a couple of days ago, because I was looking into the, you know, what thought leaders are thinking. So one possibility that has been raised from during Alan Turing's time is what he coined as the test of human machine. It's a test where a computer with artificial intelligence can reach a point, and that's a maximum point, when a computer cannot be distinguished from a human being. So it's called a Turing test. So by learning over and over and over again by different things, the computer, through this artificial intelligence, might have reached to a point where if there are two screens or two computers, both one represented by human and another by computer, they would not be able to tell that this is a computer.
Yeah.
Now for the soft robots, particularly the biological robots, they might evolve, they may have their own evolutionary track through which they may evolve into something that we may not want them to be. So that's why a concept of kill switch has been introduced. So if you design these self-emergent robots, there has to be something that when you turn on, the cells are killed, even when they're inside the body. There has to be something, and it could be also built in that after a certain time, maybe 4 days or a week, apoptotic signals are created so that they all kill themselves. So there are these serious questions being raised regarding the ethical issues and how they may evolve over time. Yeah.
Okay. So my study actually goes to these outreach activities and mm-hmm. in the camp, and was studying this robotics, and the other day he brings in a sheet. And they learned these principles of making a robot. And I look at it, and the first one or two criteria is do no harm to human. So it has to be there in the first beginning of your design.
Yeah, yeah.
And this at the end boils down our control. Right?
That's right. Yeah. I mean, there could be fundamental questions, and I don't know whether I had this discussion with Jimmy long time ago, is the, can human beings produce something that exceeds the human intelligence? Is it at all possible? Until now, the Turing test has not been successful. There have been many attempts to make the Turing test, and it turns out that at some point or another, the computer one can distinguish that this was not a human being.
It was theoretically that should be possible, because I think actually the human brain it's just like a huge amount of neurons. I think mm-hmm. if human can similarly build that amount of neurons, I think maybe it is possible to reach the human. As clever as human.
Yeah, that was Turing's hypothesis. Yeah. One can reach that
singularity, level. Right? Singularity. When that happens.
Kurzweil. Kurzweil.
Yeah.
Recently I read the news article that papers written by AI mm-hmm. Can be published very successfully without any resistance.
That's right.
So, at least the reviewers cannot distinguish.
Exactly, yeah. I watched a debate not too long ago, and I did not know that this debate was between one of the most known debater and a computer. So the whole audience, this was an IBM computer, and not too long ago, I think last year, so the whole audience, it's a big, don't know where was it, probably Stanford or one of those places, and. So the debater comes, and the debate topic was, should we support the public school system? like elementary to high school system? Should the society support by their taxpayers' money? So there's two groups of thoughts, right? One say, well, I don't have a children, so why should I pay my tax dollars to support the school? So that was the debate. And the debater was in favor of supporting, and the computer was in favor of not supporting. So the computer was given the task. And so after the debate, it was very difficult. So each one was given 15 minutes and they made their point. And then every 5 minutes, they could answer back and forth for the next 40 minutes. And then the audience was asked to rate who was a better debater. And it was almost like split. And then it was revealed that the woman was not a human being, it was a computer. Right. And then the designers came and they gave the reason. The computer had access to something like 10 billion websites and that could instantly reach and formulate an argument. And I listened to the debate, I cannot tell. So it could reach a scary level, right?
Yeah, so these are very fascinating, but I ask a question back. So in this artificial intelligence and this cognitive control things development, where are the opportunities for mechanics in the future?
I think mechanics plays not maybe, this is more on the computer science side, right? The data management, data analysis. Maybe not, again, I may be wrong, but maybe not as much as we would like to, right? Maybe not as much as we'd like to. And each discipline has their own roles to play. And we might be playing the role of creating the chip that, you know, Jigang had been working for a long time, you know, electromigration to, you know, things that, what happens when the temperature goes up, thermal problems, they're at the very deep level, right, to have the information processed fast enough. So the mechanics has its own role, but to the higher level where the data is being delegated, probably that's the CS people would do it. But they could not
find a clear opportunity, a very clear opportunity. For example, many of us learned maybe 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, there was a paper in Nature called mobile robotic chemist or something, right? But the main idea is very simple. As you just say, I want to create a new chemicals. This is a catalysis. Some experiment I can perform, get a result. I cannot do calculation is too hard. I need to perform that physical experiment. But according to the result, I need to do next experiment because I have several parameter I can change. Mm-hmm. So of course, human used to do this. But now if you bring a robot to do this, you can discover this molecule. So that's a story thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But we have been doing materials development all these years, centuries.
That's right.
And slightly generalize this, okay, I need to develop a new material, which is soft, stretchable, fatigue resistant. These things cannot be calculated. We know that, cannot. Despite decades of multi-scale nonsense, we cannot calculate these, right? You need to do physical experiment.
Yeah.
Right? But right now we use human. But clearly the machine learning technique gets improved and robotics gets improved, then material discovery can go through that loop as well. Mm-hmm. And for mechanics, you just try to participate or design this loop, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe you can help to say, oh, mechanical test is different from chemical test. Therefore, soft robot need to do this.
Mm-hmm.
And, right? Yeah. Then the whole game become different, right? We are still discovering materials, but we design the process of discovering new material.
Discovering, right, at a faster route, right?
Yeah, before the show up, yeah. Before the robot outsmart human.
Yeah.
I mean, we as mechanics people, we can help the artificial intelligence to be more intelligent. Just like Jigao mentioned, for example, that robotic chemist in the Nature cover. So the robot need to choose from around 100 million recipes and down select around less than 1,000 to do the experiment. And the way it choose this stress down select, you really need a human intervention to come up with the algorithm to teach the robot to down select from this huge amount of the possibilities over there. Similar thing for the mechanics field. If we want like a robot mechanician to help us to discover new materials, there is a lot of things we can help to make this process more efficient. Yeah, mm-hmm. I think that's something probably as mechanicians we can contribute. I want to bring this a little bit back to the earlier discussion. My original either question or comment was formed after Nanshu's question with, after listening to all these discussions. It also evolves. So first of all, thank you, Tahir, for this very fascinating talk. I think the discussion also lively. Mm-hmm. If there is one keyword from at least the earlier discussion, I think it's a synchronization. Mm-hmm. Different people ask different questions from different aspects. For example, Nanshu asked about this, can you do this multi-scale hierarchical structures to achieve certain functions? And then I remember Su Ling was talking about, oh, if you have two little cells, they don't really interact. And for example, Zhigang mentioned, okay, the insect robot. So actually we are not alone on this. About 100 years ago, between 1915 to 1930 something, Science Journal published more than 30 articles on mm-hmm. synchronization. It's on a very interesting phenomena. It's, you know, in its summertime in the southern eastern Asia, mm-hmm. if you go over there near the riverbank, yeah. you see this hundreds of meters of a stretch of the fireflies.
Yeah. Yeah.
They synchronize mm-hmm. amazingly. Yeah. It took quite some years, decades, for scientists trying to understand this without much of the understanding. Up to today, I don't think it's fully understood.
No, it is not.
Right. It is not, right? So if you're interested, there is a Cornell applied mathematician. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Okay. So he wrote a book, yeah, Sync. I'm quite sure you read his book. So there are several observations. So for example, one thing is they synchronize, but also it took almost half a century for scientists to realize not only they sync, when they flash in rhymes in a certain tempo. And that give people some hint how to control that, how to understand that. Mm-hmm. I think a couple of observations. First of all, I think this synchronization exists in many systems, and this system doesn't have to be intelligent. Mm-hmm. Okay, Nanshu, you don't really have to have a hierarchical structure intelligent system to achieve this. Think about the fireflies. The early theory, very early stage, were proposing that, okay, maybe there were very strong-minded or very influential fireflies directing everyone, but that's not the case. And with the very simple structure and biological functions of a fireflies, they can achieve this hundreds of meters, they synchronize in a nearly perfect way. Something must be simple and functional over there. Might be a oscillator and a metronome inside their body. Mm-hmm. They can sense each other with certain distance. I mean, this seems quite universal to me. I myself don't really do the study on this, but I think something simple can be done. I was reading Twitter this morning. Zhigang tweeted, what is that? All biomimics are false or are fake, but some are useful. I think I really like that. I think I don't know. This is more of a comment, and hopefully, Tahir, you have anything you want to share on this synchronization? I'm quite sure you study this a lot in depth.
Yeah. It's this firefly problem. It's first reported 300 years ago. One of the travelers on the banks of the Thai rivers. And then many, many scientists tried to understand, you know, how come they fire. In fact, they figured out that it takes 16 milliseconds for the eye to send the signal to, I think the light source is in their belly. So the signal takes about 16 milliseconds or so. And that time is too long to understand how the synchrony happens. And then, of course, Steve Strogertz from Cornell, you know, all his life is about understanding synchronization. So he took an attempt. In fact, he's the one who also studied the Millennium Bridge problem. You know, in the Millennium Bridge, the video that I showed, people are doing the dancing together, also synchronized their dynamics through their neurons. Now, they were not even looking at each other. They were just sensing the bridge, and then they're all synchronized. So I think synchrony is a major part. I think the brain relies on synchrony. The brain fires when many neurons want to do something, they all have to fire together. It is well known in psychology. I'm working with a psychologist on campus. So they think in terms of criticality. So things are happening, but then when a critical point is reached, then they achieve synchrony. They all fire at the same time and keep on firing for some time. Mm-hmm. So they rely on synchrony. So they are computing something. So there's an input and they have a certain output, but that input does not have an output until a bunch of neurons synchronize their dynamics. So it seems like an essential component in biological world, particularly for collective behavior to take place. But there may be very simple explanation how they do it. Maybe we are looking always in a complicated way. It's a question with fireflies that has not been addressed. And one of my dreams of life is going to those rivers and see them firing at the same time.
It's perfect timing now. It's just the travel, it's not easy.
I have been thinking about these problems for a long time. Mm-hmm. And I can see this time scale synchronization as from disorder to order, disordering to ordering. So for any such kind of ordering system, you need a coordinate system.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow these individual players knows their coordination.
Tahir showed this metronomes.
Yeah.
That must be well analyzed.
Yeah.
I think if I spend one afternoon, I can understand.
It's easy problem. I tell my graduate students to do it. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So that thing doesn't have a brain, doesn't have a gut, just through mechanical, maybe air.
Yeah, right? Steven did the experiment, thousands of a metronome, they can eventually synchronize.
All right. So my point is this. Somehow they have a coordinate system. What is the coordinate system you have? So we talk about in chemistry, in biochemistry, people talk about the chemotaxis. So this is chemical, this is chemical molecules or cells, the chemical gradient lay down a coordinate system.
Yep.
So that's what calls the chemotaxis.
Mm-hmm.
If you lay down a stiffness gradient, that's a mechanical gradient, and cell know how to climb from the soft to the stiffer substrate. So it turns out that I think there must be some gradient there. Without a gradient, everything is in chaos. There must be a gradient. We probably have to find the gradient. What kind of gradient could be mechanical, thermal, chemical, electrical? Without a gradient, we cannot achieve ordering. And it is the gradient that will do work, will convert the energy from one form to another.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Recently I found that when people talk about how cells can navigate sense and navigate curvatures, I found it's nothing, but just cell can recognize We can't have a gradient. That's it. Mm-hmm. Nothing special about that. Yeah. And a cell can turn this chemical gradient to mechanical gradient and vice versa to achieve this ordering. So this is just my thought. I haven't published anything there yet. But I think that the gradient has to be there.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, for more people here haven't talked. Do you guys want to say something? Rinsu? Rinsu?
Yeah, I was waiting for my turn.
Oh, okay.
Oh, sorry.
I'm Junsu. I'm a graduate student of Jigang's first group. Uh-huh. Thank you for Professor Saif. I was so inspired, and actually I learned a lot. I have several questions. It's quite specific. So I had these questions when I look into almost any kinds of biophysics papers. They usually use 2D surface to study the cell interactions, because it is easy to manipulate, maybe easy to fabricate. However, the real organisms, the living organisms, are 3D.
Mm-hmm.
Substrates are identical to itself and is permeable, it can diffuse. And there is no liquid because there is liquid, but they are only diffused. So in the case of the 2D surface, the liquids are, they can do convection,
mm-hmm.
as well as the diffusion.
Mm-hmm.
So those kind of difference makes me confused because those are different systems. And they are saying this behavior, certain behavior, is the behavior of a human system like that. So those geometry affect to behavior a lot, or those are minors points?
Depends, I think, on the system, right? If you have a group of cells, then anything a cell would release would diffuse into the media, which is very big and very fast. So before it goes to the neighbor, the signal is lost, right?
So in the case of the synchronization, I was thinking how diffusion works. So in the case of the diffusion system, let's say they are emitting certain chemical.
Correct.
Once they are stretched.
That's right, yeah.
That chemical signal will be only amplified when they are synchronized. All
correct.
Kind of system doesn't have any time scale, right?
Very, very good point. Just hold on to the thought of the time point or time scale. There is a problem. There is a well-known phenomena. It is a type of cells that when they are in starvation mode, they activate a signal and they cluster and become like a body and waits until the food comes. I don't remember the name of this. These are all single cells in nature, and high school kids or middle school kids play with them. The name just went through. So they're relying on signals from one another. So each cell is signaling to a neighbor using a chemical, release of chemical, but the chemical would also be diffused elsewhere. However, if you think of a cell releasing the chemical all the time, that is unsustainable.
Uh-huh.
It cannot produce all the time to create the gradient. So it would have to rely on time dependence. So it would release the chemical for a short time and then turn off. And that signal goes to the neighboring cell over time.
Uh-huh.
Right? And so it is like a burst of signals. Again comes the dynamics. It cannot be a steady state gradient.
So
if the cells produce this, then depending on how far they are, the signal will reach because it's diffusion dependent, the signal will reach at some point. And then they may produce their own signal, a burst of signal, and then they would reach their neighbors. Mm-hmm. So there's a thought process that maybe through these time-dependent bursts of signals, which are transferred from one to the other by diffusion and maybe convection, would allow them to synchronize. And they begin to amplify the signal. Yes. And then there's a net gradient being produced. They all reach to a certain point, certain direction, and where they begin to cluster themselves.
I have one more question. Thank you for answering that question anyway. The second question is about the cell itself. So cell is made of lipid bilayer.
Mm-hmm.
And lipid bilayer, as far as I know, they are elastic modulus is almost negligible. It's almost the same as liquid.
Mm-hmm.
And we are talking about elastic stimuli and elastic behavior, how they react depending on the strain of the cell.
Mm-hmm.
And stiffness of the lipid bilayer is almost zero. So how the cell sense the stretch or strain, even though their lipid bilayer is almost mm-hmm. liquid-like?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think it is so much the membrane. So the cells are adhered to the substrate at some anchorage sites, which is known as focalization sites or complexes. And those are connected by the intracellular components like cytoskeleton structures. Yeah. So when the substrate gets pulled, the adhesion sites get further apart from one another, mm-hmm. and the whole cell, the cytoskeleton, becomes perturbed, right?
So is it stretching or just perturbing? Because still the main cell
mm-hmm.
that emits certain signals or chemical whatever, mm-hmm. that core is almost liquid-like, even though the stretches are elastic or made of polymers or proteins.
Right. So imagine the cell is held at the ends
mm-hmm.
at two points, and these two points are connected by cytoskeletal structure like filamentous actin and other things. Those are much, much stiffer.
I see.
Ropes, right? And the membrane is actually not that soft. In fact, when you make the membrane lipid bilayer stretch, I don't remember the numbers, but it is not too soft. It can take elastic strain. People like Evan Evans did these experiments long, long time ago using suction tubes and found out the elasticity of the membrane. They're soft, but not, they can take strain, and you can have to apply a pressure gradient in the suction tube to create the curvatures, like a balloon, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the cell is attached at two points, and the two points are moving away because substrate is being strained. So the signal is sent intracellularly inside the cell because the connections between the two points are moving away.
Yeah.
So the cytoskeleton is being strained, and that might create certain response from the cell. At the same time, the membrane is also being strained, even though they may not have a high resistance against a stretch, but they're strained, and there are ion channels sitting on the membrane. They get strained, and there are stretch sensitive ion channels. So beyond a certain strain, they may open up, and that creates all kinds of signaling that may happen. So mechanics may trigger the cell functions by inducing the strain intracellularly, the components, as well as the stretch sensitive ion channels.
Thank you. I learned a lot. Thank you.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Do we have any further comments and questions from the panelists or the audience? Yeah, Jiawei, please unmute yourself.
Yeah, hi, Professor Taher. I really enjoy your talk. So I also see a great potential of your those living machines implanted in the human body to treat disease or deliver drugs. But there must be many challenges once you put those materials in the body. The one of the big challenges is the foreign body reaction from the body. So how do you, the body may, for example, the macrophage or nucleophile will attack the materials from external. How do you envision you can overcome those issues?
Mm-hmm. Good question, very good question. So the cells that so far we have used are converted from the stem cells. So the neurons were converted from the stem cells. So the goal in preventing the attack from the immune system is to take the stem cell off the individual and convert them to neurons or muscle cells or whatever type of cells you want, so that when they're placed back inside the body, because they were converted from the stem cell of the individual, they're less prone to attack by the, so they will be viewed as friendly.
So it's like a personalized therapy. So everybody has different cells. You
absolutely, yeah. That's right, that's right.
Okay,
so most of the work that we have done are coming from the stem cells. So what MIT does, the transfection conversion, we get the cells from them.
Okay, thank you. My second question is the energy source in the body. So does those materials or machines can harvest energy from the surrounding fluids?
Yeah, from the serum, from the fluid inside the body, yeah.
You mean even can harvest those nutrients from the blood or the body blood. Fluid?
Yeah, that's right. The one that we are thinking, at least, you know, again, it's long-term future, but if they're injected, so they will be getting the nutrition from the blood supply.
I see.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great. Any other questions, comments?
I have a third question, actually, if you don't mind.
Sure.
So,
yeah, sure.
The cardiomyocytes in the heart is in the three-dimensional ECM matrix, which are, you know, connected by those maybe RGD ligand. Mm-hmm. But in your case, you do 2D those actuation.
That's
so
right.
Can you comment the difference between the 3D and 2D, which may result in different outcomes or not?
Yeah, it's a good question again. In 2D, the behavior could be different from 3D. So we are just beginning to start the 3D primary cardiomyocyte, putting them in 3D collagen matrix, and to see whether the forces, the behavior, the synchronization, the interactions also translate into 3D. We think there should be, because the key mechanics remains the same, but we have not done that. And it's a good point, yeah.
Yeah, because I'm thinking, because heart beating is not simple stretch, but also involved twist.
That's right.
There's many those modes of deformation involved. So it'll be very complex.
That's system. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
I don't see any further questions coming from the participants. So let's give Tahir a very well thank you. It's a very fantastic talk and a lot of inspiring discussions coming out of it. Really inspire us a long way to think. And thank you. And thank you the audience for participating.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
So
synchronization doesn't have to be driven by thermodynamics. You see, we are at different corner of the globe and we magically synchronize our schedule. Every Wednesday, 10 a.m. Eastern time in U.S. And
right.
We come here and we enjoy. And I suggest everyone keep this synchronization at least weekly.
Yeah.
And next week, we have Professor Alan Cole from Stanford University.
Oh.
Hope to see you all there. Discussion leader will be Pradeep Sharma.
Great. Thank you. Thanks, Jiang, for organizing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, guys.
Bye.